all the dignitaries in this room. I mean, it's a privilege to be having all of you here. We know how busy you are in your own area and otherwise, and it's really very nice of you to respond to the request from ORF to be here. And what we are going to discuss, obviously, is a very important policy which affects us irrespective in which domain of public or private service we are, because as a citizen, obviously, it affects all of us in any case here. So I'll not take much time, except that about 5 to 6 weeks ago, it was a chance meeting with Mr. Sudhir Kulkarni and Dr. Deepesh, a few blocks from here, that Mr. Kulkarni wanted me to say something about the new health policy. And then when we started discussing, it became a very passionate discussion. And he was quite amazed at some of the things. For example, most of the states do not have a state health policy in our country, for example. That's the first thing. And he was wondering as to why health, primarily being a state subject under the Constitution, why is it that states do not have? Passionate. And then he said, how about putting up a roundtable conference and getting the best of the minds in the state and the city and think about it before it's too late, so that we can contribute at the national level. And that is the genesis of this workshop. Thanks to Dr. Deepesh and his team, actually, they worked very hard to send the invites, work on an agenda here, etc. So what we are going to do is a quick round of introductions, so that we know about each other and area where you would like to really focus on the national health policy as such. Deepesh then proposes to run through a few slides to give an overview of the national health policy, and then I briefly discussed with him about the proposed agenda to discuss. We have got about 3 hours to discuss roughly, etc. So everybody around the table must get an opportunity, but the broad framework we thought was how to subdivide and also aggregate the main issues coming out of the national health policy into some broad sectors as such. If anybody around the table would like to comment on that, then we can go, we'll allot a time, and then we could talk about things which are not there in the national health policy, which you think are pretty important. I've been given to understand that one of the good ways of attending to such issues would be to have a problem analysis tree. Dr. Ramakant has suggested this here, etc. We had a look at it. Dr. Sir, if I can say so without, we'll try to incorporate what you have said. But problem analysis approach is generally for a project generally, and then you say the root causes, etc. For a policy, I'm not too sure as a policy maker whether that approach is very well taken, but we'll take into account. And if anybody here has got an urgent commitment soon after, then we would like to prioritize, and without saying that we are less important, I would hope that everybody would agree to give the person a priority chance to speak in case you've got a commitment. Otherwise, we presume that all of us would be committed till 2 p.m. at least, and then we can go around. Some administrative issues I discussed with Deepesh, tea, etc., would be served here to save time. You can get your tea, coffee here also, etc., but in case we require to have a break just to stretch our limbs, we can do it at an appropriate time. This is the broad thing. I am Jayant Bhantia. I used to be the additional chief secretary of public health. I am a demographer by profession otherwise. I did my organic chemistry and then got into the IAS, and then several years down the line did demography, and that's my interest in public health among other things. I was the census commissioner in India, census commissioner in Nigeria, worked for the UN. I was in a UN assignment till last night. I came at 2 o'clock in the morning, and I'm very passionate about public health, but I'm a student only because I don't know many of the things. So I keep learning from people like you.
I'm Dr. Deepesh Reddy, a medical doctor and assistant for the open for having as much as discussion as possible. So there's nothing to fix here. But I also just want to tell quickly some logistic issues that we have washrooms here in this corner. And if someone is a little bit leaving early also, please try to have lunch. Lunch will be ready by 12:30 itself. And we have copies of the draft document. If you don't have one, we can provide that. We also have the copies of the previous health policy. If you want that also, I can get a copy for you, if you can just give us me. Yeah, and Sunil Kulkarniji is very close in SNDT meeting. He'll be joining us very soon.
My name is Ravi Ramakantan. I'm a radiologist. I was at the KM Hospital for about 40 years, perhaps, as a faculty for 30 years. After retirement, I am in the private sector. I am now associated with the Kokilaben Hospital. The things that I understand are how the BMC functions. Very closely, I've seen it for 30, 35 years. Having crossed the floor to the private sector, I know how the private sector sort of works in some way. So medical teaching, public health in terms of teaching hospitals, and to an extent, public-private partnership are things that I understand sort of. Thank you.
I'm Suleiman Merchant. I'm sorry, a radiologist again by profession, but currently Dean of Sion Hospital. And I've got a passion to improve public health. I've been associated with some of y'all in the past, and I look forward to helping this organization and others who want to improve public health in any manner. Teaching, as Dr. Ravi said, we've been in the system. I've been in the BMC for a little bit less, 1 year less than Dr. Ravi. Improving teaching, we'll be talking about how we can do that. I have a few ideas there. But anything to do with teaching, healthcare, basic things, I'm more into, I'll be talking about it later. Mr. Bhatia knows about how vitamin D can play a role in improving immunity as well as in tuberculosis. So anything to do with public health, education, otherwise I'll be happy to help anybody. Thank you.
Sanjay Nagral, I'm a student of Ravi Ramakantan, but I know didn't take radiology. So I am a surgeon. I work partly in the private sector and partly in the public sector. But the reason I'm here is I have also been associated with two organizations. One is called Forum for Medical Ethics. We run a journal called the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics. And also I'm associated with Janswasi Abhiyan, which is a national network of people's health organizations. And probably I'm the least qualified here to comment on public health.
I am Dr. Ashok Kale. I am a medical teacher, and I have worked for several years with several NGOs. And some changes in the national health policy, I had tried, and I was successful also.
I am Pramod Lele, basically a chartered accountant and a cost accountant. You'll be wondering what am I doing here. Somehow I have been associated with pharma industry for a long time. I was with Johnson & Johnson, Park Davis in senior positions, and till a year ago, I was CEO of Hinduja Hospital for nearly 11 years. Currently, I'm a management advisor to Nanavati Hospital. I'm very passionate about primary healthcare center. And while I am aware that government wants it in the government domain, I feel it has to be under public-private partnership. Thank you.
Good morning to all of you. And I'm Dr. Sulabha Akarte. I'm a medical teacher, and currently I'm a professor and head of preventive and social medicine at Grand Government Medical College and JJ Group of Hospitals here in Bombay. Our association with our subject, we are associated with, we are teaching preventive and social medicine, which is being later on practiced as public health. So we are directly and indirectly concerned with the national health policy, and I hope may be able to give valuable inputs for the today's meeting. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Meenal Kulkarni. I'm coming from Symbiosis International University, Pune, and I'm into teaching MBA hospital and healthcare management students. And here I'm representing our Dean, Dr. Rajiv Yerevdekar, who happens to be member of Nat Health and also member of Maharashtra Medical Council and Maharashtra Nursing Council. Thank you.
Namaskar. Me, Dr. Dikshit, Government Medical College, Aurangabad, Madhe, me preventive and social medicine avishay shikoto.
Good morning. I am Meena Shah More. I work with Sneha, which is an NGO founded by Dr. Fernandez, and we work in the slums of Mumbai on health of women and children. I hope to contribute today in a little way based on my experience of running projects on mother and child health.
Good morning, everybody. I am Devendra Sonavani, a student of Ayurveda medicine, has completed BAMS, then master's in public health, and presently working with Foundation for Research in Community Health, which was founded by Dr. N.S. Antia, and presently it is directed by Dr. Nargis Mistry. I am representing her. And since last 2.5 years, I am working on a maternity management and family planning related project. My interest area is Ayush in public health and maternity management guidelines. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Neetu. I work with Lawyers Collective. My organization has been working for people living with HIV for years. And since there are doctors and this is a health policy, I'm here to learn from you all about things. And somewhere we feel that this policy, even though it says ki we have to respect rights and it has a right-based approach, we don't think that has come clearly out over here. So hope I learn a lot from this conference.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Mukesh Gupta, trained as an obstetrician and gynecologist practicing in nursing home sector in Malad, Mumbai. I've been past president of the Association of Fellow Gynecologists, and I've been associate with Association of Medical Consultants as various different positions as office bearer and editor. My interest today, I will be really thankful to Dipesh and his team in the ORF to give me a chance to be here to learn and share my ideas and thoughts. The main concern for us is gradual diminution of the middle sector, middle care, you know, not just primary and the tertiary, but the secondary care sector in the overall existence in the urban sector. And there is a gross disparity at all across between the primary and the regional disparity between various different zones, which is causing a centralized policy not being able to understand the local needs. So these are the areas where we are really concerned, and that would be what I would be liking to interested in discussing.
Morning, I'm Surgeon Captain Bhandari. I'm basically just come 6 months from, just come from Delhi, and I presently I'm with the Western Naval Command. I also cover the Southern Command. I'm professor in community medicine, and my interest has been in Delhi as director health. I used to go to various states, 6-7 states, and take over district hospitals and infuse the armed forces model into those to gain experience of how actually the public health is functioning and how armed forces possibly could contribute some kind of ideas into the system.
Good morning, you all. I'm Dr. Praful Barwalia. I'm founder, trustee, and senior homeopathic physician, honorary director of Spandan Institute of Applied Homeopathy. We are running mother-child hospital, and we are running special school for disabled children. We have been instituting holistic multidisciplinary approach where homeopathic physicians along with experts from modern medicine as well as other colleagues who are related to the field of disability and mental health work together. I am member of the board of research in Maharashtra Institute of Health Sciences. Ayush in healthcare is one of the major themes.
Namaste, I am Dr. Shyam Ashtekar. I am from Nasik, and I am mostly engaged with primary care for a very long time. I was in the health services in Maharashtra. Then I was also in private sector. We worked with NGOs, with networks. My last calling was, I was director of School of Health Sciences at Maharashtra Open University. I written a couple of books in Marathi for primary care workers. And currently for the last 3-4 years, I was also associated with NRHM. Since 2005-06, and currently I am reading and writing on public health policy. That's why I'm here. Thank you.
Namaste, I'm Rajesh Nainikwal, representing Reliance Foundation here, and we are in the health outreach program since 2012 onward, and we have been working in 7 different states, having across over than 1,000 villages. So we want to assess ourselves how we are complementing national health goals and objectives through our initiatives. Thank you.
Good morning to all of you. My name is Brunel D'Souza, and I'm from the Center for Health and Mental Health, School of Social Work at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for introducing yourself. I know most of you in one way or the other. I'm extraordinarily lucky, actually. I've been the beneficiary of your advice, your expertise, when in the government, when not in the government. Currently, I'm associated with some of the NGOs who are here, present here, actually. But what I'll do is quickly request Dr. Deepesh to run through very quickly the main features of the new national health policies. You know, this is not the first national policy, but it's in continuation of the earlier one, 2002, and the previous ones here, etc. And then I would propose a format, and if by and large all of us agree, then we'll proceed accordingly. But let Dr. Deepesh take the honors first.
We also have inputs of Jana Swasthya Abhiyan as their inputs, and we also have inputs from Ravi Ramakantan ji, who has given, and Sri Ravi Duggal ji, who has been working a lot on health policy. He also has submitted his inputs. They're all traveling or in one way or the other committed elsewhere, so they couldn't come. So what I'll try to take you through the next couple of minutes, so like 10 to 12 minutes, is for what is there in the policy document. I'll just rush you through, sir. Yes. So just touch on the background of the policy here, and then situation analysis just briefed in the document, and then the vision, the policy directive set to take this vision forward, and some touching on the health policy levers. So we all know that 83 we had this first national health policy, which had this after the Alma Matal declaration, what we India had been a signatory to, which envisioned health for all as a goal by 2000 itself. And then later on we had this 2002 policy document again after this first policy. And we're also at the phase of NRHM, the first set of reforms which started around 10 years back in their end of this decade. Then Millennium Development Goals stated for 2015 also are coming to the end. So, and then the document also clearly mentioned the backdrop of all these things, we also have a strong political will to actually get this national health assurance as promised. So the next two slides are not in the document, just want to take you through the BJP manifesto, which actually clearly pointed out at that time. So health assurance for all is what they promise. We'll initiate a new health policy, initiate national health assurance mission, and consider setting up a leaner body in the place of the current regulatory bodies. Then let the Minister of Health and Family Welfare be a coordinating institution, and then AIIMS like institute for every state. And then preemptive and promotive care to be the focus. Health and hygiene being part of school curriculum. I'm just touching the brief points. National e-health authority to be set up, and mission mode to eradicate malnutrition, and also the Swachh Bharat campaign as an option to take forward the health determinants, and then managing the water and waste management and ensuring safe water. So, and then the document also has this situation analysis given around touching on these aspects. So it mentions that the Millennium Development Goals has been achieved reasonably well, and population has been stabilized, but we had this skewed sex ratio, which is not comfortable, and we have inequities across the states and also within the states versus rural and urban areas. The quality of care has been a concern, but not much elaborated, only given as an example of pregnancy-related care, but it has been still mentioned there. And national health programs, it is mentioned that we have mixed results, like especially with communicable diseases like HIV, where we did a good job, and also in polio eradication, but lagging behind on the non-communicable disease front. And NRHM has been a kind of mixed experience, again as mentioned, that strengthened the community health system in the ground. Slower. It strengthened the... NRHM, it has been mentioned that it has done a good job of strengthening community level systems, but also there is some weakness in the strategy which was taken, basically to only strengthen the RCH component and the national health programs. NUHM has been okayed in 2013, and there was a technical research group which also gave the recommendations, but it's yet to be started in a large scale. Out-of-pocket expenditure is on rise compared to around like, it mentions that 5.5% of the per capita expenditure on a monthly basis is what is being spent on health by the individuals. But anything above 10% of their per capita is what is considered as a catastrophic illness because of health. And that is actually increasing like over a period of last 8 years. From 15% in 2004, we have around like 18% as of 2 years back. And we have this state-funded insurance schemes, especially for the poor, which has been expanded mainly in large 8 states, especially in the southern states. And they are covered across 1/4 of the Indian population, but this is mainly for the poor. And RSBA, which is a central sponsor scheme, there's like not so much of uptake as it could be envisioned. Now it's actually from Minister of Labour, it's actually moved to Minister of Health and Family Welfare. This push for Ayush, and we had a policy in 2002 as well. And then just something mentioned the health industry part. So we have like 50% of health industry represented by the hospital care, pharma covering 25%, and diagnostics around 10%, equipment business around 15%. So the document also mentions that there has been a positive push for the health industry develop in a better way the last 25 years through indirect tax incentives or some direct support for hospitals to be set up in rural areas, and also in the form of tax exemptions. Then, but also it also says that strong private sector has emerged an extent of catering to almost 80% of the outpatient services and like 60% of the inpatient services. And also saying that 40% of the care being provided in the private sector is through informal or unqualified practitioners. And also mentions the private sector still delivers value for the money. Less than 30% of the total health expenditure coming from government funding, but still we are in a position to take care of 40% of the inpatient admissions, and also take care of the national health programs, also take care of the end-of-life support for critically ill people who get covered through the tertiary, the insurance schemes which has come up. And there's been a major expansion also has been mentioned in the last 10 years through various training schools for nursing and paramedics. And coming to a bit of research, research component has been strengthened again through this Department of Health Research being started in 2006. And around 12th and 5-year plan, we also have focus on promoting research in a big way around for the medical needs. But still, there's so much of pooling of health research when it comes to medical colleges. More than 96% of the health research being produced or published by just like 9 institutions across the country. That's something which has been mentioned. Then regulation routes across health has been through regulation of drugs and food safety, and then with the professional councils, and then the clinical establishment which is coming up right now. So as of now, 1% of the GDP is being spent by the government on health, and that actually translates to 4% of their entire health budget. 4% of the entire budget of Government of India. And in terms of the entire GDP is like around 4% which is being spent by both government and the people together. Policies, principles has been touched upon, just to mention the names: equity, universality, patient-centered and quality care, inclusive partnerships, pluralism, subsidiarity, we're letting the state level and lower bodies to actually own more, accountability, professionalism, integrity and ethics, lean learning and adaptive systems. Not much is mentioned on what is adaptive, it's not been detailed much. Affordability, these are the principles which have been mentioned in the document. And the objectives of the document has been mainly to have a kind of a cost-cutting strategy across various sectors which influence the health, and also focusing more on the preventive and curative and rehabilitative strategies as a whole spectrum. Then reduction of out-of-pocket expenditures and minimizing the catastrophic illness which is there right now. Universal availability of free comprehensive primary care. Comprehensive primary care is a word being used in the document right now. Universal access to free drugs, diagnostics and emergency care across. Improved access and availability of secondary and tertiary care by a mixed approach of strengthening the existing public hospitals, but also by strategic contracting of services from the private sector. Actually, this is being proposed. And influencing the health industry to be more aligned with the public health goals. And 3 policy directives, and we are coming towards the actual core of how the vision has been expected to be implemented. So by enhancing the investment in health, by taking it in a preventive and promotive approach, then some kind of policy shifts around the organization of the healthcare services. These are the 3 main policy directives as we mentioned. The first one, so how do we get the funds? Let's raise public health expenditure by the government from the current 1% of GDP to 2.5% of the GDP. Though it has been acknowledged that what has been internationally expected as 4 to 5% is the way to go forward. So this was been mentioned as this is what can be realistically spent by the government, allocated and spent, utilized by the government. and through general taxation, named health says, if needed, the way we had education says. And also a point mentioned which is not very connecting well is like 50% of the expenditure of health goes anyway for HR. So we are also creating more jobs for the people in this country, as we mentioned here. Let us also leverage CSR funds, but though in a small way. The other policy directions are, let us go on a preventive and promote to health aspect. Minister of Health to coordinate a cross sectoral policy to get this done. And also we had this Swasth Nagrik Abhiyan to come out as a health social health movement. And we also have these components feeding into it, like seven components, like Swasth Bharat Abhiyan, Nasha Mukti Abhiyan with this abuse, and Nirbhaya Nari, improving air quality, health diets, healthy diets, and then Yatri Suraksha with this road traffic accidents, stress reduction in workplace, health education to be in the part of curriculum, and also to have an assessment of impact assessment of non-health departments on the health indicators. The third main component is about what policy shifts we really need to have in the organizational system, mainly in the primary care. Currently, it's been mentioned that primary care actually takes care of 20% of the primary care needs right now in the community. So we need to rather have a very comprehensive care. We'll also try to call them as the primary health centers, as health and wellness centers, has been mentioned. In secondary and tertiary care, we currently have a kind of a narrow scope, again, concerned around medical colleges. Can we strengthen this secondary care, can we broaden it and strengthen it at the district level hospitals itself? So whatever is being provided at the medical college level, can we have them at the district district hospital level itself? And also expand the scope by also strategically outreaching, reaching out to the private sector, purchasing care from private sector. In public hospitals, so there's been a point mentioned that until now we have been thinking healthcare as a social enterprise where we have to recover the cost back. Instead, can we start looking at it as like a single tax finance system, where we don't expect the cost to be recovered back, and it will be assured free services. To strengthen the infrastructure in HR, instead of having a normative approach or maybe a budget line approach, can we have a target approach for the underserved areas? And also to improve the quality of infrastructure on the quality aspects of the health setups, it has been mentioned that the private setups can use NABL and NABH as accreditation things, but for public institutions, we can have some set of standards of quality and then see how many can reach and then incentivize towards that actually. That has been mentioned differently there. In urban health, until now it has been a sporadic pilot studies, but now the idea was to actually have more scale for it. And national programs to integrate more instead of being in a vertical program, there's been a special mention on women's health and gender perspective in this, where health systems has to take care of the entire cost of caring for the domestic violence or sexual abuse. In Ayush services, three dimensional integration. One is to strengthen the knowledge component and have this the standards clearly written. Co-location of Ayush services in all healthcare facilities, even the tertiary and secondary. And then resources to be strengthened by, let us say, human resource and also equipment and drugs which are needed. And some ways are to have bridge courses for Ayush doctors to allow them also know about allopathic medicine, being in a position to practice allopathy. That it has been tried in some of the health PSCs right now. And cross-sensitizing the doctors from different pathies about the strengths of the other pathies. And then separate central drug safety standards organized the way we have it for allopathic drugs. Can we have something separate for Ayush as well? Supporting medicinal plant farming. I'm coming close to the final points. Emergency care has been touched to have an army of community responders at the first care to strengthen the protocols in the health systems, health facilities across. To have trauma care centers so that the golden hour is actually respected. One for every 13 lakh population in urban and one for 10 lakh in rural areas. Rehabilitation also at community level. Tertiary care to be both by ways of strengthening the government institutions, because the cost of healthcare is actually escalating a lot. And then also to see if we can have 58 more medical colleges, turning the district level hospitals into medical colleges. We currently have six AIIMS-like institutions to increase that from 6 to 15. Then sanctioning of private medical colleges and their quality, and then the free structure to be a little bit reviewed at periodic interval. Let private sector, is a kind of point mentioned, but I would say it was interesting. Let private sector, which is adding to the growth of economy, be free to serve the rich, not pressing much to serve the poor, with caution that they won't be the ones who will be influencing the overall health policy for the public. Then medical tourism, hospitals in fact can be taxed extra if needed. Tertiary care, again, while involving the private sector to get the specialists which are needed for tertiary care, let us go with some caution, because the quality of family physicians coming out of tertiary care hospitals are not necessarily the best, with the exceptions of CMC and Tata Memorial, where we should probably do more. Then to also have National Health Standards organization, and to see if we can have more courses through MCA, NB, National Board of Examination, also College of Physicians and Surgeons. and also see if we can have some medical officers who are in the system to be on a priority trained on the specialties, who can be willing to be posted in a remote location and to convert this National Board of Education to a innovative body, and to secure human resource for the health more in a community level. Done before 2 minutes. So BSc in community health, bridge courses, again as I mentioned, pharmacists, and also bridge courses for pharmacists and nurses, so they can be manning these health and wellness centers. Reforms in the nursing education to have public health nurses who will also be, and also like a mini health practitioners, nurse practitioners. ASHA as a community health nurse to be strengthened further. There's so much of emphasis to strengthen the ASHA concept, to even have some certification for them via National Open School. Allied training skills also to be imparted, and public health management cadre, the way we have in Tamil Nadu for all states, and NEET as one central exam for all medical college entrants. Robust, there's a lot of financing to be handled right now to have strategic purchases in the private sector, so we need to have this robust national health account system. Then reforms in financing for even public facilities, instead of giving it just on a budget line, can we reimburse them on there and the work being done? Special setups like National Health Assurance Agency also probably might be needed to get these finances across to the private parties, and where we can have cashless scheme for the public. Regulatory framework, last two, three slides. Currently we have Clinical Establishment Act, Professional and Technical Education and Medical Technologies Act. We need to reform these four professional councils of IMA, dental and pharmacy and nursing. Need to implement this Food Safety Standards Act, which was started in 2006, but finalized in 2011 to be implemented, but it's not being implemented for shortage of staff. Medical technologists, the way governments like Tamil Nadu or Rajasthan has some good procurement systems, can we have a central level procurement agency which actually can be a guiding force for the states as well? Set up institutions like NISE was given as a reference, the way we have NICE in UK, National Institute of Clinical Excellence. Can such institutes be there to update, let the technology be updated more quickly? Last two slides, ICT on health, to have integrated health information architecture which can be accessed both by patients, healthcare providers, and also the private parties as well. This authority, as we mentioned earlier, health card to link for every patient to link their services and also the follow-up things. To build on the health informatics, to strengthen the capacity, strengthen the knowledge by the ICMR institutes, what we have 32 institutes, and the medical colleges, 293 medical colleges, where we strengthen the research activities across these 300 odd medical colleges. Operation research to be reviewing their program, to be taken up the program managers who run the program, like, you know, the program managers of national health programs. And then to have international health policy and a steering committee across all different boards. Governance aspects, state-center relationship, right now 36% of the entire health expenditure is provided from the state finance, center's funds. And also the government of India has international commitments to oblige, and also to have this decision. So for these reasons, we need to have center to have some role in this. But how do we go forward? Equity sensitive resource allocation, consultative decision making, coordinated implementation, better finance management, technical assistance to states. And then public health management cadre must hold the senior positions in the health cadre, in the health department. Civil servants to have induction programs in these domains. Minimum governance standards, maybe our boards, where CEO and also the chairman be equally accountable. States to have standards for procurement. This is what center is expecting from states. Procurement transfers, having regular district level offices, and also selection of partners and paying them what needs to be paid. People's health assembly to be held at a district level once every 3 years. And this is the last slide, trust me. Laws under review, these are various laws, and proposes health as a fundamental right. Though a national health right, through a National Health Rights Act, it has been mentioned that there's some discussion, probably are we mature enough, and we look like we can propose this. That's the kind of tone which was there. Finally, very little, only 5-6 lines on implementation has been quoted in the entire document, the final last page. Implementation, we envision implementation framework to be in place, supported by the Minister of Health and Family Welfare, to deliver on these policy commitments, and not much elaborated on that front. We are set. Thanks a lot.
No, not at all. We were aware of this. So some more colleagues have joined in the meantime, and therefore the number of participants has increased from estimated 20 to maybe very close to 30 now. And therefore you can understand how little time we'll have by 2 o'clock, even if we allowed a very democratic way of giving equal time to everybody. So let's be very brief and to the point. You are experts, so please use your expertise and your skills of oratory to really focus on the main issues. those of us who could not be present at the time of initial introduction, could we request them to please do that very quickly? Mr. Sudhin Kulkarni, you know everybody, so we need not have any introduction, please.
I'm Sneha Khandekar. I'm from Savitribai Phule Gender Resource Center of MCGM. And I'm also representing the Symbiosis Health Sciences Institute.
Thank you. Part of the mandate and request to Deepesh to finish it in 12 minutes, he took literally 17 minutes. So you can understand. I mean, it's important. Everything is important. And let's do it. So you got an overview. And the National Health Policy document has been given. It's on the website here, etc. As I said, for convenience, and if all of you agree, then what I propose to do is taking out the main features from the National Health Policy, divide into some broad sectors, roughly say four, and then allocate about half an hour each. So that is the time we reach around 1:30 and then winding up, etc. If all of you agree, then we know which are the sectors where we would like to really focus and you think you can contribute here, etc. It's important to contribute, but not necessary to contribute. If you think that there's some other area, you can wait your turn so that the experts have got this. And if I understand Mr. Kulkarni, this may not be the first and the last of the conferences here, etc. It's only a beginning actually here, etc. So depending on your commitment, I'm pretty sure ORF would like to take it forward if I can speak on your behalf. So let's not say that if we do not speak today, I mean, you will not have an opportunity in this forum. You obviously have opportunities in other forum, but this forum would also be available.
Sir, any idea when is the health policy expected to be
there? They have asked for comments by 28th of February. I presume that before the end of the calendar year, they should be able to finalize because they will wait for requests from other states. I'm pretty sure there will be a request for extensions of time as such. They will wait for the public, the various bodies here, etc. Then they will have to put it together, reorganize, and there should be a national health conference on this, I presume, where they would again give one more opportunity. And I'm pretty sure the Honorable Prime Minister and the Honorable Health Minister should be there, plus the health ministers or the chief ministers from the state. So that is broad, but I have no idea. That's the way Government of India usually works, but it could be different this time. Based on this, and kindly correct me if I have not put something particularly, I just thought we could really focus on the primary healthcare, secondary healthcare, tertiary healthcare as one big sector as such here, et cetera, where you think you can go and take those issues over there. But it could also include the urban health systems and the rural health systems in general. Just one set of discussion sector which I just thought. Now, it could involve the communities being given a priority in primary healthcare. The reason we are saying this is India, in my view, has focused far too much and for far too long on the primary health care. As a matter of fact, when I was discussing with Mr. Kulkarni, I even suggested that it's high time that we need to restructure even the title of the ministry. Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. To what extent do we really require the suffix family welfare still? Because I think there's an overemphasis in the ministry on the population stabilization, which was very important in the 1950s, 60s, 70s. And therefore, we appear to be too much focused on that, and therefore, we are not giving enough attention. But that's a small point, and it could be only semantics. But I think it does convert that the Government of India still expects the state to focus far too much on the family welfare rather than on certain other things, etc. And therefore, there are certain things follow from that. But it's only an observation. One could argue against it as well. So that is one sector. The other was taking into account the expertise in this room and what is given there, etc. We could talk about the healthcare financing, the government expenditure, GDPs, and the PPP models put together as one group, because I think that's the key. And when Deepesh was winding up, he made a very pertinent point. If you look into the entire policy document, the last paragraph is on implementation, and it tells you where the shoe pinches. And they said, whatever we might have said in policies, we are not able to implement at all, etc. And it begins with Government of India itself not in a position to finance the health sector. In spite of the fact they said that it should be 2.5% of the GDP, etc., etc., the Government of India spending itself on the NRHM has been well below. There is no apparently instrument available with Government of India to force the state governments that they must spend this much on the states. on the health aspects, actually. There's no instrument available, as a matter of fact. They can only persuade and come out with what they call, in general government terminology, a centrally sponsored scheme where government of India says, okay, we are going to contribute 50% and then you contribute 50%. There are various models, 100% centrally sponsored scheme to 20% or less, et cetera. And if I had understood the Honorable Prime Minister and the Finance Minister, they wanted to do away with this, and the Niti Aayog is, and the meeting which they are supposed to be holding, they want to take away this whole issue of the centrally sponsored scheme, which after 5 years or 10 years, depending on the funding pattern, everything comes to the state. So that is how this health financing has come, actually, over the years. All of you are witness to that in various ways. So I just thought that was one focused area. The other was about health personnel, health paramedical technicians, etc. Because unless we have that system, etc., it will be very difficult. If you wish, then we could put that also as a part of the medical research with that, etc., because that is setting up the medical college, if you agree. So we could have second sector over there. Third, I just thought was very important in terms of health legislation, regulation, use of the information technology, electronic records, the statistical system for the health as such. We don't seem to be having that enough records over there. So we could combine that, if you agree. The fourth could be health education, interdisciplinary convergence, nutrition, sanitation, whatever we have, a point was made here, etc. And the fifth could be basically what, in your view, is not in the health policy as given right now, etc. Broadly, but we can interchange these ideas. So if you agree with the basic format, or if there's any modification at this point in time, then we could allocate roughly half an hour, because we are close to 11:45 now. Half an hour still would mean 1:45 and then winding up, etc. So broadly agreed? Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. So let us have, we are not going to go back here, etc. If you have the national health policy here, you can take out the sections, or you need not to take out on this. Whatever you would like to comment on the primary health care, the secondary health care, the tertiary health care, the urban health, the rural health. Now, one of my main arguments is, luckily we've got MCGM here, etc. In the urban health policy, most of the things, even within the state, forget about government of India hardly pays any attention to urban health policies as such. But within the state, the municipal corporations are law unto themselves. There are no guidelines how much they should be spending. MCGM is an exception in the entire country, let me put it this way, maybe Chennai to some extent, but we do not have. In the village panchayats also, under the 73rd amendment, these duties of health education have been cast upon the local bodies, but there appear to be a lack of guideline on that here. So, but that is the only pre-remark. I would not like to speak too much on this. I would throw the floor open, and you could speak on any one of these issues, on primary health care, secondary health care, tertiary health care, emergency health care, urban health policies, rural health policies, participation of the communities, for example, NRHM, whatever you wish. So the floor is open. I would request, if all of us agree, let us not take more than 3 minutes or 4 minutes, because everybody's views are important, and that would give opportunity to some of our other colleagues to say something.
Yeah, that's what I was going to be a little open and honest. It might hurt a few people. I'm not sure how many from private, public, or whatever, but we are talking about the country now. So our needs of our people supersedes everybody's interest. Dipesh, Subhati, everybody's spoken about medical education. No, thanks. Right now, the basic problem is that we are not integrating whatever we have. Like, finance is a problem. This I'm talking about educational improvement for all healthcares, because we want improvement in quality of doctors. Everybody keeps saying that. And the basic thing is that already MCI, DNB, CPS have their own norms. But there is an interference from MCI into other branches like DNB and CPS, for example. That is cutting into a lot of areas. Each has its own role to play. Ministry of Health had issued a circular to MCI not to interfere with DNB a few years ago. Unfortunately, that is being sidetracked, and MCI is again doing the same thing. To cut things short, anybody who needs any help in increasing seats, I have currently put a proposal up to almost double the seats in Sion Hospital. Nair is following suit. And any medical hospital, private or public, who is affiliated to MCI, DNB, and CPS, we are trying to help CPS too, can approach me directly to see how it is done. The basic thing is very simple. Assistant professor who has the experience of an associate professor will be treated as such and given a seat in spite of not having a post. Associate professor who has a professor's experience.
I think we have got a section for health, personal health infrastructure over there. It would be more appropriate if you could speak there, if you don't wish to speak on the primary, secondary, tertiary healthcare, emergency healthcare, etc.
Sure. So I'll just come back with you. I'll come back to you later. Vitamin D in the role as an immunity booster, as in its role in TB protection. We have talked about TB, primary, secondary, tertiary. All of this need to know. I have given a couple of letters to you earlier. I think this has to come in the national policy. I was in touch with Dr. Harshvardhan. Unfortunately, he got changed. So if somebody can take that up, I'll talk to him later, give all the documents. It's 23 rupees a vial, which can be taken orally instead of an injection. 6 lakh units. Every 6 months, if our population can get, we can reduce TB, we can improve other things. TB patients to take every 3, 4, and 5 months. We have a protocol established by all our HODs. I can share that with anybody who's interested. That would be nice. And increasing the role of gene expert, which diagnoses TB within 2 hours, tells you whether the drug rifampicin is sensitive to rifampicin or not, which is a surrogate marker for isoniazid, which means you can diagnose MDR at the outset.
No, sir, can I sure. I'm not being rude. We're not talking about tuberculosis here, it's about individual diseases. We're talking about the national health policy because India would be the capital of diabetes and cardiac and everything here, sir. We could go on talking. If I can request.
Sir, no, no problem. This has to come with the national policy if you're talking about
so
change.
Take a short one, and tuberculosis is a very important disease. It's a decent
sure. So
okay.
We'll come back tomorrow later, sure.
Thank you. Dr. Shekhar, please. May I again request, I'm sorry if I'm not. I think otherwise the discussion will be all over the place here, sir. If you can restrict. And if you think that a particular disease or something is important in this particular sector which we are discussing, please do so, etc. But please do not be carried away, etc. Because you are the expert, so let us ensure that we speak in the given sector, please. Thank you.
Yeah. About the primary, secondary, tertiary issues. This document is eloquent on making primary care as kind of cornerstone of the entire health policy. And I think that is right because in many states, don't think of Maharashtra also, Maharashtra alone and southern, many states there is no primary care also in UP and Bihar also. It's a national policy, they must pay attention to proper primary care, they want to enrich that, they want to expand that. In that, I had suggested, incidentally I had written a letter to Mr. Ranjendra Chaudhary and he accepted many of the points. But the sub-center to be developed as a primary care unit, they have not paid much attention to that in this document. But if you read the NHIM, National Health Insurance Mission, actually it is to be read with this policy because that is going to come. So in that they have mentioned that right from village and also at the sub-center, we are going to develop the sub-center. So that's a promise which looks like possible from the year next. Of course, there are 1.5 lakh sub-centers. If we only focus on sub-centers, that will be a great achievement itself for primary care. So I think they're right on that. Now the second issue they are not very clear is what to do about the quacks in UP and Bihar and Orissa. Actually the health services of UP and Bihar are run by quacks, not by our doctors and nurses. So last policy also did not look at this quacks issue. This also doesn't look at it. Again, it mentions about ASHAs but most of the services are being given by quacks, informal doctors. So that has to, somehow we have to be inclusive on this. Thirdly, medical colleges, this issue, the tertiary care, is again going to come in the HR section, but I would like to focus here that medical colleges are mostly focused in the southern states, right from Maharashtra. And northern states have a shortfall of medical colleges. So the two halves have very different problems. We have overpopulation of doctors and many medical colleges.
Sorry,
if I can request, we could put it in the end. Okay, yeah. And as far as urban is concerned, they are going to have a whole new initiative on urban health services. I think that's right. Thank you. That's all, I think, as far as this is concerned, yeah.
If you could have any request in the secondary care, secondary health. private sector is depressed. But I mean, you can have your choice, but I just thought we should not lose focus. Yeah, doctor, please. I always call him doctor because he's more of a doctor than of a chartered accountant now.
Okay. Just a couple of things. I personally feel primary health care should be allowed to be under PPP. And when we worked on that, actually we were told, yes, it is possible. But when we actually approached, we were told that you have to go only in the interiors and only in the Adivasi area, then only you can get it. Whereas considering that there are 30,000 primary health care centers, it should be definitely given to the people to handle rather than government to handle. Because there are people who are willing to handle. I can take care of the entire, enough 1,800 centers are in Maharashtra, and I have got, I can say with confidence that we will be able to manage those 1,800 centers through another 10, 20 industrialists who are willing to do this, and on the same style as the government. In other words, it would still remain free, and two doctors which are required to be appointed there and which are never there in most of the primary healthcare centers would be possibly be easily appointed and controlled by the private sector, and they will be willing to pay for their fees also. So one PHC therefore should be ideally under PPP. Secondly, if at all they remain with the government, then there has to be improved accommodation for doctors and nurses. If they come to private sector will ensure that. But if they remain with that, because there is no incentive for being there is no deterrent for being there. And now we are talking of they can give 1 lakh of rupees and then they get out of that bond also, so which is the worst thing to happen. So that is why that PPP is not happening. And lastly, on this subject, there has to be need for a more dialysis center, because there is no dialysis center in the best of places, at taluka levels and tier 2, tier 3 town levels. Because that if we do, probably we can have secondary care where these kind of things are required. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lale and myself. We visited a very remote area in Thane actually a couple of years back. So he's recalling, I'm at least reminded of it. Please, yeah, next please. On the primary, secondary yes. Healthcare, urban healthcare, rural healthcare, please.
On the primary healthcare issues, I would first say that you said that we have been talking for years about the primary healthcare, but the needs are still unmet in the primary healthcare and they need to be addressed. Secondly, at the secondary and tertiary care, there is no control over the private practice, where still the 70% of the population still is catered by the private practitioners. I mean, in all the areas, including the specialist and all. So there is no definite system of even which is mentioned in the earlier policy or even in the new draft. Then the needs of knowledge and application gap, when we talk so much about the community participation, so has any introspection being done on the failures in these areas? Why are we not using the techniques of business analysis which are done in the industrial setup? And the same can be modified for the health setup to introspect on our failures in the earlier policy and then helping to frame the new policy. Then I also is of opinion that primary health center is the heart of the public health system. So a versatile nature of a primary health center must be taken care of, because a medical officer has no powers. A block development officer has more powers than the medical officer. So here he feels dejected. So something, this is just one example. We have no time to discuss on all the issues. And the thirdly, as far as the tertiary healthcare is concerned, it has a lot of relevance to the medical present medical education. Which is, though we talk on the papers about the health, need-oriented and community-based medical education, but when it comes to actual practice, it is not happening. So this approach in day-to-day practice is underestimated, not by the policy makers itself, but by the people who are actually working for the system. So do we have any concrete monitoring and evaluation of primary healthcare, secondary and tertiary healthcare at all the levels? And can policy be flexible enough for intermediary changes whenever required? Or is it a binding that once the policy is drafted, no change can be made into it?
Thank you. Yeah, we need to strengthen the public health sector. At present, which is characterized by a lot of corruption, that is one thing. So we are interested in getting MRI machines, CAT scans, and we don't get the chemicals or we don't get simple things. So that is the problem. So I had a suggestion, I don't know. If it is made mandatory for all the politicians, IS officers, IPS officers of this country to take treatment in private, only in the public sector, government hospitals, will it help to improve this sector? That is one suggestion.
Secondary healthcare services are concerned, you may belong to any faculty like surgery, medicine, pediatrics, gynec, but for treating a individual at the secondary health center, his body should be fit for treatment, and for that anemia is such a big problem. So every surgery, let it be a caesarean or any pediatrics or anything, for correction of blood level, unbanked bilateral blood transfusion has been recognized as a very good source in this national health policy itself. So in US, the practitioner, he is authorized to select a donor, collect blood, all perform all the tests and transfuse it to the needy patient without involving the blood bank. So this is called unbanked directed blood transfusion. So this unbanked blood transfusion, if it is given a due respect as it is in the US law, then every individual who is under treatment will be made fit. Otherwise, the patients are referred only because the anemia is so rampant. So, second point, this maternal mortality rate, we need to bring it down, but for the want of anesthetist and a gynecologist surgeon. But if MBBS doctor can be trained only for caesarean, and only for skin you require anesthesia. So under local anesthesia, a MBBS doctor can perform a caesar.
Scheme of government of India to do that.
No, Karnataka state has done it.
There's a government of India scheme for doing that.
Being followed. So if each and every state, the maternity mortality rate will be brought on immediately. We need not depend more on postgraduates for orthopedic, because I have worked as a MBBS doctor. I have done all surgeries. I have done all orthopedic work. So we are unnecessarily relying more on postgraduates.
Also, your point is made that we require to introduce anesthesia for MBBS. I think we should be very
right. Quickly, my 3 minutes, sir.
Yes, please.
Primary care, the major things that hurdles my experience when I had worked in a primary health care center, it comes from there. There's lack of access, lack of availability of doctors at that time, a little more regulatory pressure on the availability, and there is a lot of lacunae in poor record keeping. The importance of record keeping will tell us what is the felt need of the population in that primary health care center and the subcenters under it, which is drastically missing. And the moment we have those data, we will be able to identify occasional camps of those specialties coming from the secondary and tertiary care, and that will reduce a burden of, you know, unnecessary posting of those specialists. Second thing about secondary care, my focus is on secondary care because it has been somehow squeezed and totally removed from the system. Most of the policies, although rightly focusing on the primary health care, without diluting the need of it, we definitely need to focus on the secondary care, because the tertiary care is still a little cost heavy. Now, secondary care differs in the rural population and the urban population. In the urban areas, it is still a major forte of the private care sector, the middle-sized nursing homes and the middle-sized hospitals which are individual owned, and we need to understand their role, because still major chunk of healthcare is provided, whether it is epidemics, whether it is any major crisis is cared by them. So we need to focus on them when we are talking about urban area. Thirdly, the tertiary care, if we try to understand the primary need for having focus on primary care is lack of accessibility for the far-fetched people. If we focus on the states where there is still huge deficiency, like the Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, etc., and creating more medical colleges there which itself act as tertiary care centers, there will be huge lacunae covered up that way. Now lastly, if we have to connect these three sectors, we need to have tremendous appropriate level of transportation, which we have worked the government policies. But if we have that, the transportation, then our major problem of trying to train the untrained and providing the facilities which are substandard to the poor just because they are poor will go away. And at the same time, we will have access to immediately take them to a higher well-oiled system and machinery of secondary or tertiary care. So I would beg to differ a little of trying to
keep on focusing on enhancing the, like local anesthesia for LSCS. You cannot see LSCS, the baby may come out, but what about the PPH? What about the complication after that? The lady doesn't die of LSCS. The lady die of complications after that, which cannot be tackled by local anesthesia. So we need to focus on that. Lastly, networking and communication. If we have system of e-connection, of consultation of a primary health person for non-surgical things with a person who's sitting across on a Skype or a, on a computer, who can once in a week be there for that 1 hour, he can collect the PHC. It's very easy to collect the cases. It is very easy because of the ASHA worker. We can collect the cases and have a internet consultation, and if required only then refer. I think I'll stop here.
Thank you. You will have an opportunity to use of ICT and you can expand there. I think it's a valid point, but yes. Anybody else around? Yeah, please. Can you just please, doctor?
This whole, importance of referral system, when we're talking of primary, secondary and tertiary, what he was talking is very important. And we even if I look at urban, there is no well-defined referral system, because of which, there is a lot of pressure on Sion, and then there are a lot of facilities which are underutilized. So
talk about pressure on Mumbai. Not on Sion, I'm just saying.
Basically the tertiary, secondary and the primary. So that needs to be one. The whole aspect of quality of care that has been mentioned, and also one more aspect of gender, which I just wanted to add on. So, these things are not emphasized so much when you talk of infrastructure, human resource, all these, but the quality from three perspectives, stakeholder management and clients, all that three perspective of quality of care needs to be, focused on when we're looking at this whole implementation part of it, because it's hardly mentioned any implementation. And the gender aspect right from the medical colleges has to be, because then only we'll have that sensitive care which needs to be given to women, all that we're talking about. So that gender in medical education is very important point which needs to be, kind of emphasis. We're talking about quality.
Thank you. Yeah. Here and then, yeah. Mr. Shah More. Yeah, sir, absolutely.
And from that perspective, community health volunteers, community health workers, as well as other NGOs, if we are in a position to evolve a quite structured strategy, and if we can evolve them as an effective bridge between community and healthcare establishments, then I think our gains will be maximized to a great extent. And even that will allow us to structure in a very effective way the referral system too, which he was putting across. Now we can also utilize our various youth resources. For example, in various colleges, you have NSS cadres. Now you can utilize them, train them, they can be posted periodically, it's part of their NSS thing. Now there are so many other avenues, we should give a fresh look at it, and that perspective can allow us an effective community participation.
Thank you, Ms. Shah More. Yeah. Sneha, yeah.
There are just two points I want to make. One is, we have found that there is a sheer lack of proper valid data on the basis of which any planning or management is done. So we've demonstrated the use of mobiles, and we find that for any particular area, there is often different data available with the different public health systems. ICDS will have different data, the municipal corporation will have different data. So if there is a balance of resources based on the local
Can I
needs,
say that your points can be taken either in ICT or when we are talking about lack of data, etc. Yeah. Unless you'd like to make something on the primary urban healthcare, slum healthcare, for example, etc.
So linkages between all the different public health systems. So convergence is a very broad word, but if you look at linkages at all levels, so we find that one hand, the Department of Women and Child Development is having this new World Bank funded ISNIP project, and they are looking at bringing about convergence, but the municipal corporation and the health ministry is at another level. So as not only the referral linkages between different sections like primary, secondary within the health system, but also across say at the ward level between water, sanitation, there is mention over here, but there is no practical solution on how it can be done. We've been hearing talk about it from a long time. And also between the ICDS and municipal corporation. And
we've got a separate section on interdisciplinary convergence towards the end. You will have more opportunity there.
The third thing which constantly acts as a stumbling block is a unionization at all the public health systems. So just now the ICDS Anganwadi workers are on strike because of not receiving pay. And this brings to the standstill all the work. So the ayabais and the ward boys cannot be trained because of the unionization. The doctors and nurses are trained. So many times services are refused when women come to the facility because ayabai and ward boys turn them away. It's not the doctor who turns them away.
Okay, so management issues, not much of policy. Yeah, can I just come back to you? Yeah, please.
So the basic structure of a PHC or a CHC and a sub-district hospital works on a particular manpower strength. Now, I think we had reviewed this with the IPHS guidelines which came up.
Absolutely.
The document does not mention anything about the integration of, are we considering change of manpower? Because your population keeps growing around a PHC and a, I think we are still working on a very rudimentary model of a sub-center, six sub-centers being covered by one PHC and things like that. I think we seriously need to look at in integrating your guidelines into your policy now, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ashtekar.
Just want to add that Ayush can be very well integrated at the primary care. They have made mentions here and there, but that has to come very cogently in that.
As you see, I mean, even in this forum, from alternative healthcare, we don't have a representative, honestly, strictly speaking, except one or two, but I'm just saying. So that is totally marginalized in various ways, actually. But anyway, you are right.
I want to add on what gentlemen have said. See, in primary healthcare, in urban areas, the horizon of the primary healthcare need to be increased. We are no more limited to immunization, family planning and all. Because, as Dr. Lele suggested, dialysis center and all. Because in urban area, 50,000 population served by one PHC, the density of the population is so high and the capital of diabetes, so it is needed to be more services to be added to PHCs.
Okay, time you would like to, sir. Sorry, yeah, doctor, please go ahead.
Yeah, I just, since many of the points have already been raised, I just make a quick submission. One is strengthening of primary healthcare services, greater engagement of community participation, also defining what primary care services are. If primary healthcare is to be, I mean, what do we mean by primary healthcare and primary healthcare services? Because often it gets, we tend to reduce it to minimalist care, and that needs to be critically looked at. Mental health services at the primary healthcare level is very, very important. That integration of mental health with primary healthcare. And looking at, non-medicalizing of primary healthcare by looking at the role of other professionals or other healthcare workers who are non-clinical necessarily, because at the primary healthcare level, there is scope for other public health professionals and social work professionals or other professionals who can, non-clinical professionals who can play a greater role, especially in working with communities. Strengthening resource allocation and strengthening referral systems is what I wanted to talk about.
Thank you. If you would like to say something, you can request a second.
Emergency care has been missed out. Sorry? Emergency care has been missed out.
I said so, but there were no comments. So anyway.
So probably just one last comment that emergency care, there is an issue. Thank you. Emergency care, there is a big issue about the liability of a doctor who's practicing and to handle the emergency care. At one end, we are worried about the doctor denying the care to the needy. At other end, there is a big sword of the illegality and medical evolution with this word. Probably the national health policy can create a little soft stand on people who are giving emergency care. This will enhance the opportunity of patients to get that in a big way. So maybe a Good Samaritan law kind of thing or something. If we can have that kind of vision statement in the national policy, so this can be utilized by the judiciary to help those people to help the needy at the right time, sir.
In the amendment to the Motor Vehicles Act, which is going to be introduced now, I'm a party to that. The Good Samaritan law is being introduced over there. Okay, I'll talk out of the context later on with you. But I'm very happy that you mentioned about the Good Samaritan law, which is obviously a big stumbling block.
Because today the doctor is very scared to even stop.
I agree with you, doctor, absolutely. Dipesh, you would like to say something before I request Mr. Kulkarni, because next 5 to 6 minutes we should wind up and go to the next one.
We have been talking about this primary care right from our first national policy, but that has not been strengthened so much as we wanted, though it has been. So is there some work looking into what were the root causes why that primary health care was not strengthened, though the emphasis has been there for a long time? That is one quick point to my side. And Ravi from Anand Ji has monitored problem the approach of, can it actually find some root causes in that?
Go ahead, no, you would like to do it.
Okay, what I'd like to do is try to sum up and raise one or two important issues. Everything is important, so please do not mind if I say this is not important. That's not my intention. We talked about the whole issue of the primary healthcare, secondary, tertiary healthcare, the rural part, changes in the structure, which was suggested about the health personnel at PAC, the IPHS standards, etc. But there are two or three things which come out very, very importantly, etc., among others, I would say. One is by Mr. Lele about the PPP model for the PACs here, etc. And this has got huge implications as such here, etc. I am aware of some of the states, including Maharashtra, but Karnataka is one of the better states on this model. I think today, to the best of my knowledge, something like 30 to 40 PSCs are being run on the PPP model. Dr. Sudarshan is there, and I think he's done a tremendous work. I had an opportunity to discuss with him. I'm aware of something being done in Gujarat as well, but these are isolated cases. I thought it was a very radical thought coming from Mr. Lele that all the PSCs, 1,800 in Maharashtra, could be handed over, and the private sector and about 8 to 10 corporates take the responsibility of manning more than 1,800 PSCs, etc. Well, it's food for thought, but if you'd like to say something. The other point which came about is about the unbanked blood transfusion. I think it's an excellent point which has been made here, etc., taking into account the overall things here, etc. Then connecting the three sectors was an issue which was mentioned. I would only try to place on record here the extraordinary work done by CMC Vellore. Dr. Zakaria is there, who has been talking about preparing a district plan on all health and medical services involving the district health officer, the civil surgeon, and the medical college dean. There are three people looking after this, tertiary, primary, secondary healthcare, etc. But in India, we do not have that model. So all the three work independent of each other, and in Maharashtra, we took a broad decision if it could come out here, etc. We are trying with Wardha as the first case, but let's see. So just food for thought. Important point about primary healthcare and involvement of the community at large, actually, and this was really focused on it. It's very, very important. Accountability, there are certain issues here, etc. Can we go back to the people and saying this is what we are doing in terms of service deliveries here, etc., in sort of a people's health parliament, which is being thought about. An issue was made about mental health care being as a part of this. There are so many things which needs to be done here, etc., but mental health care, important as it is, if you go by the WHO estimate, 10% of the population suffers from some sort of a mental this thing. Suicides of farmers is one issue. Suicides being committed by students at the time of exam is another. There are several aspects to it in any case, etc. It's a major challenge. Can it be done? How do we do it? And that brings to the issue about health education at all levels. Is ASHA really going to be the ultimate model, or ASHA is going to be a very limited model here, etc.? But I would just like to stop at this point. The primary healthcare model has been evolved largely through primary vaccination as being the government's duty, basically, etc. And who does it in the urban areas? To what extent are the private sector participating in the primary healthcare in terms of immunization programs, for example? Here, this is a major issue which is there, sir. So let us work on this. I'm pretty sure there are several important things which can be said. But if I can again speak on behalf of ORF and on behalf of Mr. Kulkarni, I would request all of us who are making points as we go, if you could be kind enough to send it to Dr. Dipesh or the ORF, that would like to incorporate here, etc. Because you may not have an opportunity to say everything you wanted to say for lack of time. You may also take into account what others have contributed and you may wish to modify and go through the document. But we would really appreciate much if you could be good enough to spend, take out some time, half an hour, 1 hour, whatever, and just send it, etc. And this will be, I'm pretty sure, will be acknowledged that this is your contribution in some sense. I think that should be. Is that okay, Mr. Vijay? I thought the invitation included, but I will request him as part of the administrative arrangement towards the end. Okay, thanks. It was a very lovely participation from everybody. Yeah, please. Yeah, no, not at all. You're always welcome. We are never too late for such things.
Dr. Nagda, I am Director of Medical Education in Major Hospitals, Bombay Municipal Corporation.
Yeah.
Actually, two points I wanted to make here. One is, in the National Health Policy, mentioning about oral health and general health, they are very much related. They are not mentioned oral health at all, because it was a gateway to the good general health. Okay. And many diseases manifest themselves in the oral cavity. And not only just oral cancer, But even the periodontal health and the teeth lasting for a lifetime, that is important. The second point is, as you just mentioned, regarding the primary, secondary, tertiary working independently and repetitive also many times and not effective. That is main thing. Everywhere today it is called as social accountability and community-based education. All the hospitals should have a primary care included combined. What is happening with the municipal settings, I will tell you. Generally, the treatment, everything is done in tertiary care and in the secondary care also, but largely in the tertiary care. But the data collection from 2005 has been made, is being made by the epidemiology cell. And also, all the 5 national programs are being carried ahead by the primary. But the NUHM, NRHM fund is not completely utilized because of lack of coordination between the 2-3 sectors, one. And secondly, the accountability, responsibility of the tertiary would increase if they are also given the equal credit for it. There is a lot of being TB done by the doctors, but the TB is a separate national issue. Many of the forums, the actual treating chest medicine specialist is not there, and the TB programs are being taken ahead by the TB hospital and other people who are there in the NRHM, NUHM and all, because they are answerable to the government that to show the figures.
Short what I said.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Very quick, I think, thanks for your contribution. Maharashtra was possibly the first state to introduce a dental or oral health policy, actually, providing for dental health care right up to the sub-district level, tehsil level, etc. I will introduce it among other things, etc. So there are very few states, I agree with you, etc. But let's move on. I think we need to move on. Thanks for your contribution. There are two equally important in my view, but we can decide. I think we have talked about a lot of interest has been generated regarding the availability of the health personnel, the institution, the medical colleges, the health infrastructure as such, etc., the paramedical, absence of paramedical technicians and so on and so forth. We are putting it as one sector here, etc. I would invite your views on this here. What we are saying here also, among other things, is when I was in charge of health, we had a meeting with the director of health and several other people, etc., and the simple questions which I just asked them, it was simple in my view, sir. If I am a 2-year-old child or an 80-year-old person and I slip and fall in a village and I break my bone or apparently, etc., I have to go 100 kilometers to get my x-ray done, even in the 21st century. That's the first thing. If I got a chest pain and I come to the primary health center, etc., and ask my doctor, I've got some problem with my chest here, etc., is it a cardiac problem or something like that here, etc., the answer is I'm only responsible for the primary health care. I have nothing to do with anything else here, etc. I cannot take an ECG. I cannot interpret an ECG. I'm not authorized in courts to do it here, etc., which was shocking in some sense here, etc. On the other hand, the same person who cannot be given the service from the PSC doctor just walks across the PSC to, in courts without offending anybody, a BMS doctor, he takes the ECG, he gives whatever, etc., etc. So there's a big dichotomy over there, etc. And the third thing which I said is, if I have a problem with my teeth, which was just mentioned here, etc., as a 4-year-old child or whatever, etc., I have to go to the nearest weekly market to get my dental fixed. There's no health, there's no dental policy in that sense, availability, etc. Incidentally, there's no shortage of BDS in the country as such here, etc. In some sense, there is no shortage of the colleges as such here, sir, but we have not been able to evolve. So there is a mismatch at times here in the country, etc. I leave it at this. There, I'm pretty sure, very excellent anecdotes which all of you would like to say. So how do we ensure the whole issue of putting up medical colleges and the infrastructure related with paramedical services, the super specialty hospital, the medical colleges here, etc.? Floor is open for discussion. And you can really contribute here. I'm pretty sure we've got eminent persons from the medical colleges and also from other field who can contribute in this. Dr. Suleiman, yeah?
This is a wonderful way to start this, but I'd have offered suggestions for the long term, but temporarily, right now, what we can do without adding any money to it, Dr. Nagda has already approved that. Our additional commissioner has already approved that. There is a new circular by the Medical Council of India that permits an expansion of seats on an as-is, where-is basis. It's called a deemed status, deemed teacher status. So if anybody needs to be helped on that, I can expand later to save time here. Each and every medical college, whether private or government, can do that. I just have a request for Mr. Bhatia to request Sudhindu Kulkarni, if he can help us with expediting government municipal approvals like they do it for private, meaning inspections are done after the admissions, prior, anytime between the admission and the examination of those students who are admitted. This would change. Right now, we are literally almost doubling our seats. So if somebody can help, the only thing is the process is a little complex. Going to MUHS first, then going to Ministry of Health, then going to MCI. So if we can do it, if we can do it like private medical colleges are allowed somehow, that before the exam, students are allowed to be admitted, especially for expansion, not new medical college. They already established teachers. Rely on the hospital doctors who are qualified MCI inspectors, who are DNB inspectors, so on and so forth. So if we can expedite that, we can double it. Anybody wants to know, I can show them right now what to do. So there is a procedure. It's all as per rules. One. Secondly, what was mentioned earlier was, I'll just repeat the last line for Susan Kulkarni. If somebody can help through Ministry of Health, Government of India, and insist on the long drawn out procedures for recognition, which are already there. There are two aspects. One is a new college, you need to be very certain that everything is in order. There also, private medical colleges get a little preference, whereas government colleges are always at the raw end of the stick. Secondly, for already existing colleges, there are certain rules which permit seat expansion. That again follows a rule going through MUHS, going through Ministry of Health, going through MCI. Right now, we have in the municipal corporation proposed an increased seat. I have luckily spoken to Dr. Jamkar, MUHS. He has said he will expedite. I have already spoken to somebody in the MCI. They said they will help. But as per rules, if they follow, it will be a long procedure. If somebody can help me with this in the next 2 months, the seats can be doubled in entire municipal corporation, which is not a joke because each such seat... Yeah, sure. I just want to say that this each seat is sold for 3 crores in private, whereby they produce substandard doctors, and the healthcare can be improved by improving the existing.
This is the issue which needs to be addressed, because in the country, I think they are putting our lives into danger with the proliferation of the private medical college on one hand, etc., with the sort of services they are giving, their capacity, etc. I think these are some of the key issues which need to. So how do we really increase the infrastructure in terms of medical colleges in the country, etc.? All of us have been talking about the population ratio per doctor, etc. How do we really do it, etc.?
Basically, one is a long-term plan how to increase, produce more. But right now, what we have, as is various basis, if you allow that increase as per legal laws, it will solve at least 30% of the problem. Not specialists, this is all categories. Right from UG seats, in fact, UG seats, Sion Hospital, for example, has 100. We can go up to 180 easily, 150, 180, 200. With a minor...
Okay, if I can provoke... the optimum size in terms of maximum in a medical college, why should it be 100 or 180?
Why can't we have medical colleges to produce 1,000 medical students in per medical college? What requires to be done? The world has it in any case. Why are we not there? The staff, this, etc. But how do we get over this, etc.? Please, I think we require your thoughts on that.
We have got a myth about scarcity of doctors in this country. If you look at the doctor population ratio, we are calculating only allopathic doctors. If I can speak on this personal issue. Because there are Ayurvedic and homeopathic doctors, equal number, around 8 lakh allopathic and 8 lakh other doctors. So if you calculate them and calculate doctor population ratio, we don't require any more doctors. General practitioners, at least. So pumping more and more doctors in the system is only creating malpractice, more and more malpractice. So this we have to take care of this, that doctor population ratio, India is the only country where we are having doctors from all other pathies. So we have to be careful about this while pumping more doctors in the system. That is very important.
Okay, so your argument is we don't require more doctors. Fair enough. Okay. I'm pretty sure there will be very strong reactions, but please go ahead. Yeah. No, and please then, let him finish. Let him finish.
What has happened is the entrance examinations for PG courses has degraded the standard of UG courses, MBBS. Our doctors are not able to do anything because they are only preparing for the entrance exams. So something should be done about that.
Thank you. Yeah, doctor, we'll come back to you. There's some.
As Dr. Dixit has mentioned about the Ayush medical colleges. See, in Maharashtra, 105 Ayush medical colleges are there, but those are not linked with the PSC system. And because of that, their role and their involvement in the PSC system is very limited. So I guess through this policy, that issue should be addressed. Additionally, there is in policy, there is mentioned that there should be cadre like BSC, those who will serve as a community health practitioners or like this. In Assam, there is a rural health practitioner cadre, but their career path is not defined. So introduction of such any additional cadre or through medical education would be again a trouble, can be a problem. So that should be discussed over here, I guess. Yeah.
Why don't you initiate the discussion about this is the whole issue which the previous government wanted to introduce those three-year courses and everybody was up in arms against them, etc. Please, if you would like to say something.
See, through
are you for it or against it?
Yes, I am for to it, actually.
You are for it, okay. Dr. Ashtekar, please.
As far as the doctors' numbers are concerned, in southern states, we don't need any more doctors. In northern states, we need all the doctors that we are able to prepare. And doctors don't migrate to other states because of linguistic problems. So it's better to focus on other states. This is a national health policy. So we can be saying that we need doctors, but not in southern states. And what this point is right, that if you pump more doctors in the southern states, it's going to actually be counterproductive. So where to think about that? Secondly, level of training of general doctors and the postgraduate doctors is miserable even in Maharashtra. Now, Dr. Bapat told me that it's such a horrible situation, but unless we do drastically something to improve this situation, we are not going to get good doctors. They are going to be only Shylocks hereafter. So we have to attend to that. I would advise scrap CET, scrap postgraduate entrance test, make it state level, and improve the systems downwards. And placement is more important than creating more doctors. And one of the solutions is to make each medical college, government medical college of a district as a headquarter of all the services and connect all the PSCs and the CSCs to the medical college and merge these two departments. Only then we'll be able to really know how many doctors we need. Otherwise, it's not possible.
Thank you, Dr. Sam. While we'll request Dr. Ramakant, we'll just come back. Yeah, please. Okay, Dr. Ramakant, please. 1 minute. But I would request that let us not focus only on the doctors. We have got nurses, we have got technicians, we have got several other people in the health personnel. While I agree that most of us would like to discuss about that, I would request some of us to indulge into that as well. Please. Well, we are not focusing on Maharashtra. We are talking about the national health policy. We are talking about nursing homes. We are talking about pharmacists. We are talking about technicians of all kinds. And the reason I would like to put it here, sorry, Dr. Sabha, just 1 minute. See, we have been talking about the demographic dividend in this country. And we have been talking about the skill development in this country. And this is one sector which is badly required in any case here, sir. And the opportunities are enormous. But while we have got challenges of producing the various kinds of doctors and the specialists and the super specialists here, etc., what about the technicians as such here, etc.? Any number of stories from anybody around the table and outside would say that ultimately is the ward boy or somebody who's trained to actually we help you as a technician at the end of the day, basically, etc. And there is a big challenge about that and there's a big opportunity. How do we really exploit it? And the national health policy, in my view, is not really talking so much about the development of the skills of the technicians and the paramedical staff, etc. But Dr. Sir, please go ahead.
We all the time talk about the quality of quantity of doctors, but the tragedy is that we never talk about the quality of doctors. And this is so important at a national level because the quality of the doctor will determine the economics of the whole healthcare system. And we've seen this is one area, and I've been around for 40 years looking at medical care. There has been a steady decline in the intellectual and emotional quality of medical graduates. And that is the direct responsibility of medical colleges, and I'm treading on many toes here, and I really don't care. And it reflects on the quality of medical teachers that we have in at least the city of Bombay. I think the biggest disaster is allowing medical teachers to do private practice. I feel as a policy, at the national level, it should be banned. Because if you go to medical colleges there, more often than not, you will not find a medical teacher. You will see that the highest level of care is provided by the lecturer or by the registrar. This cannot be corrected unless there is a ban, and then the deans are empowered to take action. If this does not happen, the quality of medical education is completely abysmal in teaching hospitals. Students learn without touching patients, without visiting wards. And I don't want to say anything about private hospitals. I think private medical colleges, by and large, with rare exceptions, are a disaster, and that should be also stopped.
But I think very, very pertinent points. I'm happy that somebody is speaking out. And
so I know for technicians, I think there's a great shortage. I think we need to work on that. But the only solution initially would be the theory part. We could have online courses. And the practical part, we could give assignments to various hospitals to give them the experience. That could be a shortcut rather than having separate courses and separate universities with fixed numbers. That would really solve a lot of problem. And quality should be taken care of during practical experience.
We'll just go down the line, please. Yeah.
I have seen ophthalmic surgeons doing a job of an optometrist. I have seen obstetrician doing a job of a dai. So our skill development to an MBBS doctor, if it is done, then we need not have more colleges. I agree totally with Jagannath Dixit. If you pump doctors, the malpractices will flourish. And it's still today it is a lot of malpractices are going on. Because number of patients, number of clients, and number of doctors, the ratio is so bad that for getting one patient, you need to bribe the general practitioner in 50%, 40%. So the quality of MBBS doctors, graduate doctors, has gone down only because, as he said, we need to scrap that entrance test. When I was an intern, I used to do, in 12 months, I learned many things. I did appendix, I did tonsils, I did DNC, because I was not bothered about a PG entrance. I was not holding the books in my hand. So if we upgrade the skill of our graduate doctors, as he has rightly said, then we did not go for postgraduates. And you said in the very beginning, if in a village somebody has a tooth problem, I used to treat the patient. If there is a fracture, I used to reduce in my own practice. So if we upgrade the skill of doctors, that is possible only if we scrap all the entrance tests of PGE and whatnot, everything.
Thank you. Just one or two points on medical colleges, especially in metropolis, can be in two shifts. Somebody has to think seriously about it. Because that will avoid the problem of new colleges to be created, at least or till the time they are created, they could be in two shifts. One.
Infrastructure, doctor, but
infrastructure.
The staff, the academics would be...
Definitely, because the other one. Yeah. Secondly, courses for paramedics. Under MUHS also, even in Maharashtra, there are 13 courses available. Post-HSC, three-year courses are available. Unfortunately, nobody pays attention to them. And unless and until we start, first of all, not many people even know those courses exist. Secondly, so they will have to be highlighted, brought on the main page rather than on the some internal page, one. Secondly, in an ambulance, today we expect MBBS doctor. Recently, the amendment was done for a BMS, etc., which is so bad, you don't require a doctor because doctor, a paramedic is one who does the trick all over abroad. Nowhere you find paramedics. And as a result, all our ambulances which became popular now under 108 could not be started earlier because of a requirement of a doctor for that kind of. So secondly, thirdly, lastly, on nurses also, the common entrance test which has been started and being insisted, it will result in less number of nurses. I think we should scrap that common entrance test, one. Secondly, nurses are not getting the respect they deserve, maybe because of quality of education. Then we need to strengthen quality of education. That will reduce the burden on doctors. And unless and until we, abroad when you go, the nurse virtually can even prescribe a medicine. Nurse virtually can tell a doctor because she has that courage of conviction which is given by the education. Now that is the kind of thing to happen. Then the pressures on doctors will go down and doctors will not be underemployed in that sense. Today all the doctors, what are we saying? They are actually getting underemployed because instead of doing the medical related duties, they are doing all kinds of duties because the secondary support staff is not available.
Excellent point about absence of secondary support system, but please go ahead. Yeah, we'll dwell on it a little more.
Yeah. We were all talking about the quality of education. For this, we need to mainstream the faculty development enhancement within this policy. Because unless the faculty is now development occurs and new methods, contemporary methods of education is completely encompassed in the colleges, we cannot talk of DCI, MCA not having enough syllabus. And also, sir, when the number of colleges are more, for example, Dental College 303, and there are, I think,
80% people not getting jobs. So government and the family welfare, everybody should take action. No more dental colleges, at least that is required. People, there is a case of suicide in Patiala after doing MDS, the girl did not get a job. So this should be addressed. In countries like Netherlands in 92, I have seen closing down colleges when it is not essential. Thirdly, sir, if at all you want the BMS and other people to do allopathy, they should be, first of all, empowered to do it. I would say that Ayurveda is a constitution-based medicine, which I strongly believe in and take it. So now if they can make awareness in public where it is a motherland where Ayurveda was born, and we are now wanting them to do allopathy is wrong. If at all this awareness that Ayurveda is the more effective way of medicine, that would work rather than they succumbing to become allopath. And it's very, very important. The culture of the country is such that we do not respect the paramedical staff. And period, sir, there is nothing more. The doctors need to be, culture to be changed, that the nurse and the paramedical staff are equally or more important.
Thank you. I think this is a very raw now. I'm pretty sure we'll have opportunity. That's why I said we have to restrict. But government of Maharashtra went ahead asking the homeopaths and Ayurvedas to do everything, and it's already being challenged. You have a huge things, but please go ahead. We'll just come back, please.
The policy focuses, I'll just put it in brief. The policy focuses on social and environmental determinants of health. But are we truly exposing our medical graduates through the existing education program, education system, and the laws that are governing, the laws that are framed by the medical council and the universities? Are we really exposing them to prepare them to get sensitized on the social and environmental determinants of health?
Sir, when we are...
I would like to highlight here the need of care delivery standards that are provided by these paramedical and other professionals, that there is a need to have regular recertification through nodal agencies of these paramedic staff to ensure good care delivery at various levels of healthcare. Also, where we need to promote nursing professional to join in more academic conferences. We just ignore them. We do not promote them to go and represent their stake in such forums. We should promote it so that it, sir has mentioned, can be taken care of, including secondary support services in that context. So that is my submission.
Okay, actually the Union Minister for Skill Development was visiting Symbiosis. That is the reason, I'm just by the way anyway, but please go ahead. Yeah, Dr. Sahab, here please, we'll just come back. You want to say something?
Yes, sir. I think issues are deeper. When we are talking of teacher, medical teacher, he is not somebody who is just bombarding facts or giving certain presentation. He has to imbibe values, which are absolutely lacking in the current scenario. Are we in a position to integrate medical ethics and humanity in our curriculum? Are we teaching them actively? Unless we address these core issues, we'll not be able to overcome this. Right from the first year, when young adolescent student enters the medical campaign, he should be exposed to this core faculty of humanities and ethics. And then he should be gradually exposed to his environment. And then he will be in a position to appreciate the pathos which are there around, and then the sensitivity will develop over a period of time. Another important point is that there is paradigm shift if we try to perceive the health and disease. All along there has been a lot of dwelling on biomedical model. Now we have definitely shifted to biopsychosocial model. And if that is the perspective, then perspective has to be holistic. You can't afford to treat patient as a commodity and move ahead. Unless you take up that holistic perspective, we will not be able to address these malicious issues which are like malignant cancer. I fully agree that producing more doctors at times is in a way giving rise to a lot of malpractices, if this is without addressing those issues. Now, Ayush renamed in 2003, 1995 we had ISM&H. The purpose was upgrading Indian system of medicine and homeopathy with respect to the quality care, with respect to the research, with respect to a definite excellence in these areas and trying to get best out of it. The systems are best. As Madam said, system has its own philosophical foundation. Just by converting Ayush practitioner to allopathic practitioner, we are going to destroy the very rich, you know, basis of these fantastic disciplines and our own inheritance. We need to give a definite proper thought and see to it that the purpose of Ayush, they are being actually operationalized from the standpoint of research and education. Now, I'll tell you, Ayurveda and homeopathy are the sciences. Just 1 minute, I'll finish, sir. These are the sciences which has given the world the best books on medical ethics. Why not modern medicine pays attention to that? Why can't we have orientation to Ayush medical faculties from first MBBS onwards? And let all medicos get oriented towards other disciplines. Sir, you rightly said that Ayush is marginalized. If we want to overcome that, our medicos should be exposed to the right kind of Ayush from the first year. Then they will develop what exactly the right type of Ayush is. And then we'll be able to integrate them properly in our mainstream. Thank you.
So we have a medical education on one hand, and we have a public health system which we've all been discussing. I don't think they're well integrated, sir. Because medical, paramedical staff, nursing, technicians, whatever you're generating, are you able to make it in a way compulsory and create a health cadre which will serve in the rural sectors? Because 70% of your population doesn't even touch. So that's how you get exposed to whatever we keep talking about, quacks and private practices and a lot of things happening in rural areas. I think our system has failed in integrating what you used to call as the Rome system, medical education being tuned up for rural sectors. I don't think we have. And Ayush integration, which he's talking about, sir, basically our entire emphasis was on allopathy because we were more on diagnostics and we started on very, very basic health sciences. But now with the tertiary care centers coming up in a big way and private sectors zooming up, Ayush integration is important for our systems now.
That reminds me, sir, just 1 minute. That not we are talking about paramedics only, about the diagnosis facilities available and the courses for that. Actually, that's as important. Whatever we may like to integrate Ayush and give importance to Ayurveda here, etc. But I think increasingly we are more and more dependent on the diagnostic services, and the lack of diagnostic services in the rural area is a big question mark. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Yes, sir. At the outset, I would like to draw attention to the geographical distribution of the medical colleges in our country and the lack of medical facilities, practitioners, consultants, and doctors available in various different zones. So what here we are looking at tunnel vision of our problems with excessive doctors in Maharashtra or Karnataka is not the same with the Bimaru, or I'm sorry for the use of the word, but Bihar, Maharashtra, and other regions. So point, yeah. So let's move. So this is one point I want to make. Second point is, if we have that policy where there is proposed policy that increase number of medical colleges to be sanctioned in this particular zone as a reservation thing kind of thing, that would be more superior thing than anything else. Means more colleges in that area where it is needed. Secondly, I have a perspective where private medical colleges, although have been discounted as poor training centers, I beg to differ here. It is not about the private or the government colleges or the government run or state run, but it is more to do with the quality of education provided in whichever sector, and where the objective assessment of the training modules are done in such a way that the training is good enough. Now, next point is about the nurses and the nursing assistant. Now, I am extremely passionate about this because we have been running n number of courses for the training of nursing assistants instead of nurses. The problem here is disparity between the policymakers and the lawmakers. The policy and the vision process, as very beautifully put across by Mr. Pramod Lele, with difficulty I'm saying Mr. and not Doctor. So, you know, the vision is amazing that these courses are there, n number of courses are there. But even after doing those courses, the official recognition and permission of utilizing those nurses by the nursing home in the hospital is still not available. What we need to do as a policy here is to create opportunity for getting them certified by objectively structured clinical examination and the theory exams, which Dr. Merchant was mentioning about. If we are able to execute those things, we will be incorporating them. My thought process about the training of medical colleges and the quality versus the quantity. So the quality, we have got amazing doctors in our country and the teachers are amazing, there's no doubt. It's just that the application is not happening. There is a lacunae for training of soft skills, which includes things like communication skills, things like psychology, that is patient psychology, things like laws governing medical practice and related to medical practice. They have to be taught right at the beginning, and things related to, you know, communication when it came of in case of mishap and troubleshooting. So these are the points I would like to add. Thank you.
So a very quick point. So a very quick point I would like to make. We are talking in context of human resource for health, and we have touched doctors and till nurses we have come, but we are missing a very important cadre of human resource for health is ASHAs and link worker in rural and urban context respectively. Even though we have built the capacity and we made available doctors and nurses, these are these community health worker which will link community to the health system and increase the utilization. So skill building in terms of soft skills and communication of these community health worker is very important. So I would like to suggest a PPP model in capacity building and skill building of this link workers and ASHAs in rural area. And also there is one point in the policy of addition of second community health worker to complement the ASHA. So it would be, I mean, it should be a more elaborative and explanatory what they actually mean.
Only one or two paradoxes that are there about the Ayush doctors. I will just like to highlight that yes, 90% of the GP sector is occupied by BMS and BHMS in this country. That is one thing. One side, we are saying foreign countries, nurse assistants giving medicines, we are happy about that. And on the other side, the doctors who have learned for 4.5 years, if you give them some training and allow them limited cross practice. But this cannot be done by any state. It has to be done by the parliament of this country and allowing them to practice that. That is what I'm saying.
A very brief submission. If we believe in the social determinants of health and if we really believe in the need for community mobilizing, monitoring, valuation and participation, then we need to look at non-clinical professionals also in the field of health, especially at the primary care level or at the community level. We need to look at public health professionals, we need to look at mental health professionals and how they will fit into a larger team of a multidisciplinary team. The point about the ASHA has already been made. So I think there is a strong role for non-clinical professionals also in the field of health.
So since this is the first time I'm speaking, I may be allowed 3.5 minutes instead of 3 minutes. And out of those half minutes, I'm going to take 10 seconds to also, I think, say that Sudhin Kulkarni has his birthday today, so it's a good way to... All of you have the document prepared by the Janswasthya Abhiyan, which is being separately submitted, but I largely agree with the points made in the document, but I just want to take the opportunity of the medical education discussion to point out that the history of the so-called PPP model in India, if one studies what PPP has done in India, the history says that it has largely worked only in the interest of the private sector. And I want to point out the example of this very city of a hospital being connected to a medical private medical college, which probably took the Mumbai Municipal Corporation for a ride. So we must be careful about PPPs because I think it's a slippery slope and it may have worked in very small micro settings, but to adopt PPP as a model, I think is admission of the fact from the state that they want to withdraw, that they cannot do something. And I think it's therefore the issue that needs to be flagged is that it's a slippery slope before we expand it into other areas. And before I conclude, I just want to say that it was brought up, I'm going back to the previous session, sorry about that. We have a complete failure in this country on the front of emergency care, complete failure in trauma care, and it cuts across everything, strata of care, all pathies. People are dying in this city. We had a long session in this very, very conference hall sometime back. And I think the ambulance care, the emergency care, is something that government must legislate on. Right now, it's to individual initiatives, and this is, and this is one area where I think policy and legislation can make a big difference. Whether it's ambulances which are well equipped by paramedics, I think there's a huge need of accountability. In this city alone, I say this in the presence of deans and Dr. Nagda, that people regularly die in ambulances going from hospital to hospital. I have seen two deaths in the last 2 weeks in a hospital I work with. People, because there is no CT scan available, you're transporting patients and people are dying in ambulances. So it's one area where legislation, accountability, and state intervention can immediately make a difference.
I think a very important point being made on the social sector is the government has a tendency to withdraw, allowing and preponderance of the private sector, leaving the poor, the marginalized, remote people totally at the mercy, actually, without getting access. And this is not 21st century India, but that's a broad point.
Just one point on the medical professor and the ethics.
I personally feel I totally agree that medical professors need to be respected much more, not by just not allowing them private practice, but they should be compensated adequately. Because on a larger subject, we in India have forgotten to respect the teachers, not just medical teachers. The real problem, a country, it's an often quoted thing, but we have forgotten that. Where the scientists, teachers, and the lawmakers are not respected, we'll never make a progress. That is where we are. So I think this is what we need to do. Like medical professors, each and every teachers we need to respect. So not only in healthcare policy, this should be on the top of the agenda of any government, but that is missing. So I especially special request to Mr. Sudhindra Kulkarni on that.
Can I just add that practice was started only because we don't want only theoreticians. We wanted people who would have the practical and wet-handed. But it was misused in the long run. So I think we need to look back whether they are going only for one place or many places. And it was not very good taste to have the punitive action against big people, like teachers, and students will not look at them with a good light. There is an issue in that.
Okay, I think time to wind up now, this particular session. Okay, I know there would be two very one, but if we allow one, but Dr. Ashtekar, please.
See, one of the problems of this NHP, if you look at the document, they want to make a single council of the medics and paramedics, but they're leaving out Ayush and homeopathy. So Ayush. So that needs to be integrated in the NCA. There has to be a single body of council. Otherwise, they'll keep out Ayush forever.
So just one suggestion, solution to what double shifts, which is really nice, but faculty would take objection, but there's another solution. National Informatics Council has a government rate contract for virtual classrooms. If it can be made compulsory for all medical colleges, at least the big ones, we can increase our seats that way, and that's a very quick way to go.
I mentioned I wanted to take it the ICT, but it's
not possible. Only one point, that accreditation of such programs should be mandatory.
Absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Okay, just time to wind up and then move on to the next session. I mean, very entertaining session, very engaging session. A lot of new thoughts have come up. Thanks to all the participants and for the individual experts. We would again reiterate the point that please jot down with a little effort and please do it, because I'm pretty sure you are now enough agitated mentally and your faculties of the brains are working much faster than it was one hour ago. Just two or three important points I just would like to. Maharashtra, we have this whole issue about having medical college in more and more of these things, districts here, etc. As a result, the district hospital institution has died in Maharashtra. I mean, you have just replaced or substituted medical colleges from the district hospital. So there's virtually no secondary care in that sense available straight away. There's a major challenge here, etc. We have been formulating a policy of ensuring that they should coexist. Now, how do we go about doing it? We need to have a district hospital in addition to the medical colleges. Converting them one into another has led to a lot of problems. I don't want to take your time. Number two, this whole issue
And the point which was made initially that the ministers, the senior bureaucrats, etc., don't go to the public hospital. I'll just give you an example. Lack of doctors in the PACs, getting them into the rural areas, remote areas, tribal areas. So Maharashtra government came 20 years ago with a policy that out of the two MBBS medical officers in a PSC, one of them could be BAMS. Fair enough. You at least have access to something here, etc. Over the years, this has transformed into, we are not even getting that, so can you have a homeopath? And now a Unani, for example, here, etc. All sorts of things have happened here, sir. So let us be aware of such of the things. Now, people who have come and argued when I was in the health, say, as the health secretary, etc., that you need to promote alternative medicines, and the argument was that they should be practicing, etc. Then I asked the concerned ministers who were putting it in the cabinet, sir, would you, okay, in your district, we are going to start with this experiment and put the Unani and the Ayurveda and whatever you have, and take away the MBBS and put it in some other tribal areas. They said, no. Immediately, nobody wants to get personally treated at the hands of such of these people, etc. So there are huge challenges, what you say and what you would like to practice. So this is a major challenge which we are going to have. But I'm very happy that several points have come up, largely about the disconnect which needs to be introduced if you want to have quality academic professors and lecturers in the medical colleges and giving them their due, etc. The whole issue on the accreditation of the skills of the nursing and various courses and bringing on the front page and not somewhere in the middle, and several other issues. Dr. Supay is here, all of you know, so Dr. maybe, I mean, everybody knows him in any case. I don't think he requires any further introduction. So we are now in the third session now, and we are talking about the healthcare financing, the private spending, the government spending, the CSR, the PPP models. How do we ensure that the private, the marginalized people, the remote people, at least get to see a hospital before they die, or a doctor before they die? They don't die without getting diagnosed here, etc. We are talking about 21st century, and we have been talking about right to health. Now, introducing these things as a part of the law or the constitution is the easiest thing. Getting them implemented, and as I said, that is where the shoe pinches. We'll not find the personnel, we won't find the will, we don't find the finances, everything is there. So it's a mockery in some sense here, etc. So how do we go about doing it? Financing is a very, very key. What role can the CSR play? Obviously, the government would expect this, I mean, deficit from government treasuries to be made up by CSR. I think it's a horrible solution, to say the least here, etc. But that is the way people have started thinking in terms of the CSR, among others. But let's go about it. And the key issue is, which is a part of the Clinical Establishment Act and some other acts here, etc., standardization of rates. Now, just when you go to a lawyer, for example, it's an open-ended bill. You never know for your case how much you will end up paying. So it happens if you go to a private hospital in general, if you go to some private practitioner and the diagnosis is an open-ended bill. You never know how much you are going to pay. So there is, in that sense, no accountability in that sense. And that is where we talk about 70% of the health expenditure coming from private pockets and so on and so forth. And the last point I would like to say is about people who are in the unorganized sector. They live on a daily basis, daily breadwinners. Let's take the case of, say, 100,000, 1 lakh taxi drivers or whatever number we have in Mumbai. Comes the month of June, July, August, September, and Mumbai is flooded with all sorts of dengues and malarias and colds and cough. One driver is knocked out for 3 days. Imagine what happens to his family, because he is on a daily surviving basis. And the cost of the diagnosis and the returning back to normalcy is enormous. And the person doesn't have recourse to a health assurance in that sense. And the person lands up paying 30,000-40,000, which he takes at a Pathani rate of interest. And it's a whole chain of things here, etc. So there are several issues in health financing. I leave these thoughts here and open the floor for discussion, please. Must spend, municipal corporations, village panchayats suspending, Zilla Parishad suspending, the government suspending, and the private sector. Please, yeah, I mean, it's a very wide subject, but.
Yeah. A reality check. This is actually one of the most important areas of this policy. Even if you spend all the time, I think that will be justified. Now here, private spending is about 3% of GDP, and 1% is about government spending. I had suggested that unless you think of harnessing the private expenditure to the national cause, you cannot solve this problem because increasing 1% to 2% is itself so difficult. And actually we want something like 5% to do universal healthcare. So this is a tall talk, and I don't think we'll be able to cross even 1.5% in the next 2 years. So one of the ways is to do this is to open up the Jeevandayi, the RSBY, and the health trust that they're going to make. This is all there in the NHM. Let the middle class and higher middle classes take membership. Let them contribute voluntarily to this trust and Jeevandayi, etc. You have kept it only for BPL now. You can open it up, and other sectors can take advantage of that. This is how you can actually go on increasing the public pool. You may not increase the tax revenue, but you will be able to increase the public pool, and that is the only way of today to improve the public sector spending on this. Let people contribute to this trust or the Jeevandayi scheme. As far as the PPP is concerned, I think the house may be divided, and there's a lot of talk also about also against PPP. But one of the middle ways is to open up PCPs. PCPs, instead of public-private, you can start public charitable partnerships. Only do cooperation with charitable hospitals or charitable organizations or the CSR. So that is one way of solving this problem instead of going to the retail private sector. And this is one way of solving the problems of many states immediately. Even from the next year, you can start doing this. I think these two things are important. And we must caution that a lot of people have been saying about health expenditure, we have very low expenditure, but together we have 4%. And Sri Lanka, Thailand also are spending only 4%. Now, if you look at the OECD countries, the level is about 9%. And even then, NHS is broke. NHS cannot, their waiting periods are about three years for hernia. So even with that kind of spending, it's not possible to give justice to its people. So instead of going that route of NHS, making universal health care, the rights, and spending for 5%, 9%, all this is bottomless pit. So I think we should be realistic on this. Take these two, three measures and start solving the problem in an incremental way rather than making a gung-ho kind of approach. Let's be incremental, let's be gradual. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mr. Lele, please.
I'm on a slightly different subject, but healthcare financing from a different perspective. Why is the healthcare costly? I'm talking about tertiary healthcare now. A cath lab costs 4 crores, CT costs 6 crores, MRI costs 8 crores, and LA costs close to 20 crores. Now, that is the kind of situation we have got. Why do we pay that cost? It's because nothing is manufactured in India. So the first thing we need to do is make in India. Encourage GE, Siemens, Philips of this world to start setting up factories in India. If necessary, force them to set up factories, incentivize them, create special economic zones which have been created for other purposes, should be created for this. This is not a new thing. We have been crying horse about this with the government for last 10 years. As Association of Hospital Chairman also, I had taken up this from time to time. But we have no time for this. Classic example is pharmaceutical industry is doing far better today because they have been manufacturing all their equipments as well as these things. No doubt it is not as capital intensive as healthcare is, but this is what should be the order of the day, and we should work on that because that will make a lot of things much more easier, much more faster. Need for medical insurance. Now the other thing, I can talk about Rajiv Gandhi Swasthya Bima Yojana, etc., because I don't want to get into that because we are not arguing here. But the important thing is those things are not likely to work. Because they are for BPL, therefore it is okay. They are virtually, none of the hospitals have opted for RSBY, mainly because the rates given there are at least 40 to 60% lower than what are the current rates at the hospitals, which are tertiary care hospitals. Secondly, the payments are never received in time, but this is not the forum. So I think cost of financing, first of all, we should reduce in the long run the cost of these equipments, which are really, just to give you for the benefit of everybody again, why it becomes costly. Typically, if a tertiary care hospital is to be set up today, per bed cost is anywhere between 60 lakhs to a crore of rupees for a tertiary care hospital, not to mention the land cost. Land cost depends upon whether you are setting up in Bombay, Aurangabad, Titwala, or wherever. Now, that is the kind of scenario there. We set up a hospital in secondary care hospital in Titwala, that is what sir was referring earlier, 40-bedded hospital, still it costed us 5 crores of rupees for a secondary care. But important thing therefore is anything of tertiary care costs 60 lakhs to 1 crore of rupees. If you really want, because then it must have all these equipment, then only you can get into this. And not these top equipments, but even the lower equipments. Only L&T have tried little bit in creating monitors, patient monitors and stuff like that. Unfortunately, it didn't work out. So we need to encourage those innovations, creativity and local manufacturing. Maybe encourage them to set up those kind of units here. GE have set up something in Bangalore, but still they're manufacturing only X-ray tubes. Now one needs to get into this lot more in detail, and that should be part of the policy. So as a policy, we should encourage setting up these kind of things in special economic zones.
What is the market for the medical equipment? Like we talk about the pharmaceutical market in India, what is the market like for production of equipment in what we require?
Yeah.
India's, I mean, what India imports in some sense?
It's quite huge, because I can tell you today, I've
10,000 crores a year?
Easily.
I think the one important issue here is to stress on preventive health care, because we are talking of diagnosis. Before the MRIs and CTs, a lot of clinical diagnosis was made. But today, because of whatever the patient taking to the court or whatever it is, this has increased unnecessary also. So healthcare cost can come down. And there is nothing for the middle class. And RGJY, who is benefiting? The private hospitals are benefiting basically. I understand the patients also. But the patient has to pay extra if he wants in some of the private sectors. They're surviving on this RGJY, but still the patient has to pay. So I think there should be something available for the middle class. And the more stress on lifestyle disease and preventive healthcare will bring down the healthcare much lower.
Yeah, we were talking about, I want to bring back the focus on the financing of this state responsibility and what the private sector can do and some other things, etc. But I would like to again reiterate two or three important things so that we have contributions on these issues here, etc. One is what I was mentioning about the production of the healthcare. It is an open-ended thing, etc. Even in the private, Mr. Lely spoke about certain things, 40-50% other than the whatever the government is paying. But is it predictable? It is known. In, just like you go to the best of the five-star hotel, you know what are your room charges, what are your menu charges. You go to, it's a menu which is driven open and public transparency is there. That appears to be lacking, broadly speaking. Number two, we talked about the health insurance or the health assurance models, which we talked about, etc. And as I said repeatedly, for the poor and the marginalized and the tribal and whatever we have, the minorities, whatever phrase which you would like to use, at the end of the day, do not get it. The other issue is, for example, the Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, which is different from the other insurance schemes. Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana was introduced by Government of India. And that is another issue. It goes to the another ministry, and it is not with the health ministry at all. Actually, it goes to the labor ministry over there. And therefore, there is a dichotomy, like in several other sectors which we see. So there is a big challenge as to the programs which are meant primarily for one sector when they get across for whatever reasons, etc. And the last and the most critical point here is, and that is what we are trying to say about financing from the state at least and from various other sources. One of the important contributors now in India for driving people to poverty is health expenditures. And unless we are going to do, and state cannot shy away from this. There's no doubt about it in my mind, at least here, sir. So how do we ensure, on one hand, more government allocation, more government spending, people's participation, and trying to ensure that people are not driven into poverty because of health expenditures, sir? I think I just wanted to refocus on this. Please go ahead.
Sir,
yeah.
Most companies want, I've interacted with a few on those, they want to do something but they don't know how to do. So if a body can be set up in the corporation, in the government, and this is for that particular state, I'm sure there'll be much more responses for the CSR activities.
Okay, MCGM already has a CSR cell in any case. Most of the companies are coming out with something. What you are talking about, Doctor, I agree, etc. Off the shelf, project should be available. Somebody is interested in somebody's, Mr. Lele mentioned about the lack of dialysis facilities. Somebody would be interested in putting up some linear accelerator. Depends on whatever your priority. How does it cost? What is the cost of this project in terms of the equipment, the building, the running of the technicians, everything, etc.? And at the end of the day,
what is the patient going to be charged, how much the patient will be able to pay, how much we are going to, because putting up is fine, getting it operationalized is very difficult. Please go ahead, Dr. Gupta.
Yeah, sir, my point on the, my take on this particular aspect is, when we look at costing analysis of the healthcare, we are dividing the healthcare. There are a lot of PSM professors here, and we always talk about primary prevention, secondary prevention, tertiary prevention. The returns of investment, the ROI, when we invest on the primary prevention, when it comes to life expectancy or the productive years, is much, much, much higher as compared to when we invest on the tertiary prevention. The number of people who are touched upon and benefited by a primary prevention activity, for those uninitiated, primary prevention is prevention of the disease, and secondary is early diagnosis and treatment. So when we focus on that, that is going to be one of the major things. And this is where everyone, whether it is the nurses, paramedics, IS doctors, everybody can play a very important role, and they can be paid out well. Where will the money come from? CSR activities has been definitely a major source of income, because there is regulatory issues are not there. They'll reach out to the larger people, so the corporates are much more interested to do such activities. So we have a ready-made available model. We need to implement and execute it. I will move to the next point. The next point is about the standardization of charges when it comes to the healthcare sector. Sir, there has been a lot of challenges. We at Association of Medical Consultant and also at the Medical Association of Fellow Gynecology, we try to standardize. In fact, we picked up a small pocket of OB practice or gynec practice, and we have worked on a lot of models. Now, the challenges here is A, the geography, B, the experience of the person, and most important variable is C, the patient. The patient sometimes may be a very regular patient, or sometimes may be highly complicated. Now, regular delivery may not be costing, and suddenly she lands up with PPH. So we need to understand when we are standardization is done, and then instead of passing it on to the insurance sector, the insurance company forcing the preferred provider network list and saying that these are the charges, it has to come out from the medical associations and the bodies, and that is where we will be able to score, when we are able to give them a broad outline that this is the charges. Because we cannot tell a professional who is much more senior than a junior that you will have to charge say A amount and you will be similar to that. So that is going to be always a challenge. So let us accept the ground reality, which is acceptable to the service provider, and with that perspective, standardize the charges. Standardization of charges is needed, but we need to keep some opportunity for complications and rare situations without being biased to the patients, because we need the patients to get the best facility. Lastly, about the overall picture in the country today, the healthcare setups, we cannot compete the Nordic nations, as Madam was mentioning earlier about Norway, etc. We can never reach that level, because it is huge amount of stage funding, and if you look at the graph about the amount of per capita income they are spending, we will not reach that. So let us focus on what we have today. Today, there is no waiting period, whether the person is in a very far-fetched rural area or in a Mumbai city, waiting period for a surgery like hernia. The problem is waiting period for the major surgeries, interventional surgeries, the cardiac care, etc., or specialized services like the pediatric surgery. But that is not because of the cost only, but that is also because of lack of availability of specialists for that. So we need to understand that we are making too much of noise on waiting period, but when actually the waiting period is not the primary concern. The primary concern is availability of resources and the equipments at the right time. I think I'll stop here.
I would agree, but you see, the point is not about waiting period. People do not have access even. Forget about, they don't see a hospital. Please, Dr. Sir.
I think the national health policy has to very clearly make a case for increasing expenditure, government spending on health. We have to increase government spending on health. There are ways and means that can be done, because unless we recognize that health is a public good and a social good, we will not be making that kind of an investment.
You're talking about the expenditure. Yeah. In our days, some 30 years back, unindicated appendectomy, tonsillectomy were prevailing. These days, unindicated hysterectomy. There are villages I know, Dr. Shyam Ashtekar also knows, not a single woman above age of 30 years will have a uterus. So unindicated hysterectomies, unindicated bypass surgeries, unindicated seizures. In our days, the caesarean rate was 10%. Now it is exceeding 50%. And this is the whole burden, the expenditure. So if we curb on the unindicated, so if we have some agency so that we can have a second opinion, or on the lines of MTP center, due to failed of contraceptive this thing, if we start a caesarean center so that every, though it is said that it is not a law that after first caesar, repeat caesar is a must, but it is invariably a repeat caesar. So if you have a alternate measure so that a nursing, this thing, municipal corporation establishes a caesarean center for 5,000 rupees, then the rate will come down from all the private. Now, due to caesar, MTP cannot be done for a woman who has a one or two scars. So the MTP rates have gone up. So unindicated surgeries, unindicated admissions, unindicated bypass surgeries, if they are all removed to a substantial level, then you pointed out a way that expenditure, saving money is saving earning money. Yeah. So this particular, I am a consumer activist, for all these unindicated surgeries, if we bring it down, the problem will solve. People are selling their lands and gold only for attending unindicated operations.
Thank you, Dr. Ashtekar would be responding to some of the issues. We'll take up some of these issues as a part of the legislation also and the regulatory authority which is required, because you have suggested certain things here.
See, we have to understand that the national health policy that we are discussing does not really deal much with the private sector as it is today. It wants to leave out the corporate sector, it wants to leave the private sector except by way of regulation. The focus, rightly, is on developing the public sector, where the primary care centers, community health centers, and medical colleges, tertiary centers. That is the right policy. We cannot do much about private sector by way of NHPs. You're not going to close the private sector. So we're not going to discuss the rates of what caesars you are charging, etc. That is not the issue here. If they want to make available secondary care and tertiary care to the poor people through government support, they are going to contract only with charitable hospitals. This is the clear statement in NHP. So let us not confuse all this, and let us focus on how we can develop public sector. Now we are answerable that out of the 400 CSCs here, we're not able to get even 10% doing caesars. So your capacity is lying at 11. If you increase it from 1% to 2% of GDP, these are not going to work. So where are we? What's happening to their medical colleges? After 2 p.m., there is no doctor in the medical colleges. So even if you increase the money, and we are paying quite good rates in to the professors, 1.75 lakhs per month. So even if we increase the spending, this is not going to take care about your public institutes. So they are going to talk about outcome-based payments for public sector. I think these two things are to be understood in the NHP, and I think they have done it rightly. And let us reinforce these issues.
On the issue of catastrophic spending leading to poverty, there are a number of things I have faced in work and which can be incorporated in the health policy. One is that the sheer availability of primary health care. I have been told repeatedly that there is enough money in BMC, but still there are so many different development planning guidelines, and we've had discussion, and all the different multiple guidelines talk of different ratio of bed availability to population, and the discussions on them have stopped even at the ward level. So there is no follow-up. Whenever there's a policy, when it comes to implementing, it's just lost. And so one is the availability. If there is no place for a help post, you can still increase the outreach staff. So effective outreach, like someone talked about prevention, Dr. Nagra talked about prevention. So one is prevention doesn't happen through effective outreach. Once the person fall ill, there is not sufficient primary health care. Then things escalate and lead to senior. So the role of ASHA and the referral to be done, and the referral follow-up, which also brings into play the migration from rural to urban. Somewhere in the national health policy, I have not read it so thoroughly, but I did not find any mention of migration and follow-up. In ICDS, I'm told that they discriminate between population which is permanent and population which is temporary and migrant. This kind of discrimination for health and all doesn't work. And most of the poor people I work with don't have Aadhaar cards. So there is no effective system to bring the poorest within the administrative, that they exist officially. There is no official recognition that these poor people exist. And till that is done, there's no follow-up, there's no acceptance that so many populations are moving and the health needs continue and need to be met.
Okay, special attention for the migrant population. Doctor?
Basic public health model, sir, we have already discussed equity, community participation, but when it comes to health spending, what we are missing out is we have a districts in which you have your chief medical officers and he's sitting with the DM, which is an IAS cadre already well created in our country. I think we need to integrate our entire strengthening of our finance at the district level. If you make the chief medical officer with the DMs responsible for their respective districts, which I have personally experienced, though I'm urban oriented, trained, but working in that environment, you tend to understand that you need to have intersectoral coordination. What he brought out was, I think we keep focusing ourselves on medicine and health as one sector, but there are many other sectors in our rural areas where the DM would be an appropriate person, where the chief medical officer will have to integrate and then go down to CHCs and PHCs and integrate the whole system at the district level, sir.
Just one sentence. Sir, only one point. When 80% of outpatient care and 60% of inpatient care is from private sector, how can we afford to ignore them in our policy guidelines? Now, cut and commission is provided by tertiary care private hospital today. Is it not escalating cost of healthcare? What do we do about it in policy guidelines?
And sir, like a lot of schemes are bound by certain limited funds. For example, BPL. If BPL person is in that bracket, that he can be served by various. So is there any reference to increase the limit of the BPL population? For example, some says 50,000 annual income. 50,000 annual income today's scenario in city like Bombay, nobody can take the benefit of medical services. Sir. A person cannot survive in Bombay if having less than income, a lakh of a rupee. So they need to be addressed because a lot of refusal is there in the super specialty hospital on that, but you are not a BPL person or get the authentic documentation, etc.
Thank you. We need to wind up this session, please. Okay, the lady's hand is here, so we need to, please go ahead.
The policy doesn't look at the earlier failures from our earlier program. So it's important that we learn from our failures and give our inputs because there is so much of means we have finances and they are sent back. We say that the budget was allocated, but it's not used. Like for HIV, we had recently heard that a lot of amount went to Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So a health initiative means there was an amount allocated for a health initiative. Why wasn't it used? We need to use that amount and we need to learn from our we need to learn from these things ki how we need to use these expenditures or how we need to use these budgets and then even recommend in our policies that whatever money is allocated has to be used.
Can I speak on
what
this?
You are trying to say is there should be something known as a non-lapsable fund pool basically.
Of course, that
is what you are saying. For certain of the social sectors, extremely important. It's a policy decision because well, the government accounting doesn't work like that, unfortunately.
This is because a doctor or the teacher or the dean is expected to act like a finance manager, an administrative head, as well as multitask like a Mahakali with 10 hands and all. So that is not possible. Now the government should realize and incorporate in the mainstreaming those whose work they are supposed to do and who are expert in that.
Okay, I think it's a very, very sensitive point. I thought symbiosis when we gave the chance for health personnel should be health accountants and health management system. I mean, government of Maharashtra for sure doesn't have that in existence. I argued vehemently. I mean, you expect the civil surgeon, you expect the dean to look after the electricity, look after the class 4, everything. It's ridiculous to say the least. We are spending the precious time of a scarce resource of a technician of a high order on such silly things. But on the other hand, we have the experience of JJ College, I'm mentioning that name here, where a post was created just like the Mumbai University to manage the examinations for running an administrative dean sort of a thing, etc. The medical fraternity didn't like too much. So it's a very touchy subject, but we leave it at that.
The issue is there are certain things which we need to understand should be left only to the health management people. Absolutely no doubt about it. Just what it is done in the corporate sector. Health accounting, absolutely to be left. Why should be the DNB spending time signing bills of all kinds here? It's ridiculous to say the least, but that's the way we are. And I don't think policies will take care of this. We'll require to do the implementation, etc. We need to add somewhere a sentence on that. We need to stop discussion on this one. And it's been, again, a very, very engaging one. And I'm pretty sure that if we were to sit for 3 days, we'd still be as much enthusiastic to discuss. But we need to move ahead, as I said. I'm not summarizing because, as I said, we are running against time. I do not know whether lunch can wait or all of you can wait, but let's move on this. Shall we serve the lunch on the table to get more time? If the popular view is lunch on the table, it's a working lunch or an elaborate lunch, I do not know, but whatever it is. Let's move on to health legislation, regulatory systems, and various other things. Now, just to give you a perspective, various laws during British times had somewhere a mention on public health as a public nuisance here, etc. And you can go to various this thing. If you go to any of the state health website, you will find so many laws. And a point which was made, I mean, very, very strongly by several of the speakers here, is a medical student should be exposed to the laws and everything here, etc. Because you do not know. And the laws are increasing every day. As a matter of fact, there was one of those rare sessions when the chief minister of the state, when we were young officers, asked there would be no agenda. The district magistrates could bring their own agenda. And I said one of the things is, sir, at the end of every legislative session, the officers should be told that these are the new laws to be implemented and they are accountable and responsible for implementing. We do not know. I'll give you another example. The PCPNDT Act, which is there, which has been talked about so much here, etc. The UNFPA and several governments had to take special classes of the judiciary to tell the judicial officers that a law exists like this. Otherwise, I mean, they were not even aware. So, I mean, there are huge challenges and you are expecting the doctors to know everything. We require to have a special model, but it's important. Let's talk about certain more things about biomedical waste treatment. There are so many other aspects to the legislation which is there, sir. And I would just throw up this discussion because it's extremely important. While on one hand, we need to have laws, how do we implement them? There are cross-cutting issues here, etc. I was going through making some preparations for this convention conference here, etc. And I landed up with a Public Health Act of the Government of Kerala of 2009. And it's a very important act and it is a very elaborate one. But obviously, public health policies cannot emanate from public laws as such, but they are an important ingredient and constituent of this, etc. So I just thought maybe there are several laws there, but this huge. When I was in the health as a health department, we tried to create a directory of all the laws because this is one of the important things. Anybody joins the public health department, a young doctor, you should tell them these are the laws which govern you actually in some way or the other, etc. Because the poor person is prosecuted no ends administratively and legally, no ends actually. Leave it at that. Ball is thrown open. The court discussions for legislation, regulatory side, legislations as such, etc. I mean, I'll just give you an example. Dr. Suleiman is here, Dr. Supe is here. Notification of diseases is a British hereditary which we have taken here. So we had a major challenge even in getting tuberculosis data on that. I'm just trying to say how difficult it is things here, etc. Should MCGM its own laws? There are national laws, state laws, local laws, all sorts of things which are there, etc. Doctor, please go ahead.
So there are too many laws, but one small thing I want to say is that post-mortem departments use this ancient British law, after 5:30 no PM will be done. This was probably based on the time when there was no electricity, there was under candlelight. So many people suffer as a result of this. My opinion is very simple. I don't know what the forensic people will say. 24 hours, like the rest of the services, we can definitely have, depending on manpower. I think it alleviates a lot of pain and suffering. Once somebody has died, we need to respect that and move further. That's all I'll say. There are many other laws, but this small thing would help a lot of people.
Driving and harassment which goes to the public, even in the city of mostly in Mumbai, but all over the place. It's a terrible thing. The person is dead, you can't do a damn thing till you do so many things else. Please go ahead anyway.
actually many times these laws are prepared by somebody who is does not have his health. For example, MPCB. Now look at the ETP necessary. You know, everybody gets a notice that you need an tea plant in your department. Now look at any hospital, Sion or KM. You have to have a huge space to develop an ETP plant, and it will be having all that smell. It will never do what it really needed. But even in NABH, you will have that kind of a clause. But there are now different methods which are easily available, you know, which can really take a small space. And there are a lot of methods which are used in many places in India, but they are not accepted by MPCB. I think these kind of changes need to be really done in our probably legislations, which are now taking, looking forward. At the same time, they are trying to be more compatible. Otherwise, what happens, there is a legislation, and there is always a problem that we are not following those legislations. And this happens at every place. You know, Nursing Home Act law, the same issues are there. When you talk about MPCB, all those issues which can be really taken straight
just
forward.
Just to add to what he is saying, like, as a CEO, I have gone through that. Any number of people, deans would have gone through that. Biomedical waste disposal, no clear-cut guidelines. Somebody will be appointed by municipality who will come and collect. Somewhere, we are told to keep it three segregation. That fellow collects in one basket. So starting with that. Secondly, sewage treatment or effluent treatment, as is rightly said. Existing hospital, what do they do? Is it really... should be treated like a factory or a hospital should be treated differently? There are different methods of waste disposal available. Incinerator, some people insist on that. Environmental issues which are there. As recent as day before yesterday, 45 meters height has been cleared for the hospital. If somebody doesn't know, it was 30 meters till recently. Yes. Yes. Many hospitals got stuck because of that, including JJ Hospital, new building. Yes, okay. But there is a reason for that, because if there are non-ambulatory patients, how do you bring them down in case of fire? That is how that particular thing has been drafted. So unless it is explained to the people, there is a chaos and everybody thinks it's on the whims and fancies of someone. And nursing homes in societies, they should have two different entrances and stuff like that. Today what has happened is all the things are existing, and therefore any law which has to be brought in, one has to think through the whole thing. Now that think through is not happening, and somebody puts on a particular cap, not realizing there are many other hats that you need to have, and therefore these kind of laws come in, and then there is a dissonance with the whole thing. What I'm objecting is to the dissonance. What I'm objecting is to the general feeling of the public that hospital wale chore hai, these people don't want to follow this, and those kind of things, and which is not helping anybody. It is only creating a social disturbance, and not really, even those methods which should be done, those laws can be fulfilled by the hospitals, in the process they don't fulfill that. And that is what we need to avoid.
One more important thing is having
regulatory,
then FDA comes into play. The first thing, FDA has got certain things, and every time there is a ADR or any other thing, it comes that the drug, there was no mistake of the drug. That is one thing. Dual control of FDA as well as public health on the food and type of food and food poisoning, where cake poisoning occurred in Mumbai, about 400 children fell ill in one of the schools, and the corporation said that this is only agency to say hygienic place or not, and FDA ke purview mein hai, and FDA did not give. So this sort of a dislink, and also medical education and health are not separate. You can't have two different ministries for that, and even the agency secretaries for that. It has to be together. And all these policies and regulatory bodies should work in unison, and it should be given in the same, there should be convergence.
Okay, since you raised this issue about FDA, etc., and too many ministries here, etc., let's take the case of Maharashtra and some others. I just wanted to, while we are discussing this, should Maharashtra be continuing with this public health department and medical education research department as two different entities with FDA? I'm just saying, and this is a pattern across the country. As a matter of fact, those states which do not have two are introducing two.
Yeah. Okay, please go ahead
So I may just clarify that biomedical waste was never taken up as an issue by the medical people. We never learned about our infectious part till the Ministry of Environment woke us up. So, and the Gazette notification of 1998, there are rules on it. And unfortunately, now it is with the pollution control boards. I mean, for the armed forces, we are separate. We are considered a state separate from pollution boards. That's one, sir. Secondly, this surrogate pregnancies, ARTs, your organ retrieval and banking systems, which is happening around. I don't think there are clear-cut guidelines mentioned. I think the policy has to have it, because it may be more urban-oriented today, but I think you need to have some legislation on these kind of things, which is happening now, sir.
I'm so happy that you mentioned about surrogate pregnancies. I mean, we know Gujarat has become the world global capital of surrogate pregnancies, the organ donations, etc. We require much clear legislation. Doctor, please go ahead. Sorry, just yes,
yeah. I think you are talking about the guidelines and legislations. You know, actually, if you really look at the history of ethics, I'm sure Nagral is also there. When in ICMR started, all these were ethical guidelines, and most of the ethics committees used to have guidelines. Now then came the Schedule Y, and now it has become a legislation. Now legislation has brought a lot of limitations to the clinical innovations. And if you really look at the number of trials which are done in our country, have dropped down tremendously in last 2012-13. Now it is coming up. But there is always other side to this. Some of these areas need to be self-controlled, as well as there has to be only guidelines. And some areas we need to have legislations. So we need to have that clarity in our thoughts. This is one area where we need only guidelines and ethical kind of and control, and other places we need legislations. Legislations, if you try to replace for every guideline, we will have a lot of problem in an abstract science like our medicine. And that is something we need to also understand in all this.
A very important point. I mean, the fact is that most of our professional bodies, I'm talking on a very sense, they lay down some ethics, but they never implement them. Never implement them. Professional bodies I'm talking
exactly.
about. Actually, and there are a small number of black sheep which destroy the reputation of these professional bodies, but there is no internal
control.
Cleaning mechanism. You have to go to the political executive, you have to go to the judiciary, you have to go to media to really raise these issues here, etc. But anyway, please go ahead, Dr.
Yeah, regarding the regulatory framework, one of the primary focus is accessibility to health for us when we talk about national health policy. And there comes the role for development of the smaller sector nursing homes and the smaller sector individual owned setups. Now we definitely need to move towards one window approach, where it is A, the access to all the permissions or whatever should be through one place instead of running to 40-50 licenses, and B, a time-bound approach. A person right from the time, that because of this, there is a lot of problems at the individual, instead of making a cost-effective setup, they try to move to, so there is absolutely almost disappearance of the 70%, 72% service sector from the individual-owned smaller sectors, which is saving a huge cost, not just of the state, but also of the insurance sector, and thereby the population at large. So that is one point I wanted to make, that it should be a single window and time bound. Okay. The second point that I am trying to make is that a lot of laws are existent, and but the we cannot keep on making new laws to implement those old because of the failure of implementation of old laws. So when we talk about whether it is PCPNDT, whether it is talking about the surrogacy, talking about, we need to look at what are the existing laws and look at implementation as a primary measure, rather than looking at creating new laws. Very nicely put, that there is difference between guidelines and laws, and if we do not clear that in mind, we'll fail. Lastly, about the FDA regulations and regarding the even the pharmacy council, and regarding the medical, the legislation governing the medical, Maharashtra Medical Council, etc. Now, I think we need to really look at the present day-to-day affairs. And so at one end, we're talking about giving more autonomy to these organizations. And other end, we are not having elections and not having the people in the right place. And, so this thing has to be made again time-bound, that you cannot have these kind of bodies running for a pretty long time without any responsible person.
One more important thing is that the various agencies involved, the various stakeholders, like in organ donation, the police is involved. Apart, they don't know that the laws, and then we had to call upon the municipal commissioner and send a letter and do. Similar thing happens at every level, that there is no convergence. The top-down approach which government is following is not working out, and also the law which has become, like, for the prevention of sexual harassment workplace, there are a lot of areas where it is not placed because lack of ignorance of the doctors or the stakeholders, everybody.
One point, although we like bashing at the government, but don't forget you are the government. Okay?
Yes.
So we are beating ourselves.
One point I missed on pricing. So we are looking at reducing the cost, but at the same time the cost is escalating because of unwarranted investigations. And they are happening
more often for saving the safeguarding their future.
A selection was made here, but
for the solution is this, that if we have a ceiling, today the person thinks ki 5000 ka investigation karoge to mujhe 50 lakh dena padega, 5 crore dena padega. So if we have a ceiling of maximum liability to be paid out for a non-terminal or non-mortality thing, probably we will be able to save a lot of money on investigation.
I mean, this point was made, like in terms of the women not having uteruses, etc., whether a second tumectomy or whatever is required here. Doctor, please, we have got a lot of interest here, but we are running against time, please.
Just two quick points. One, what Dr. Nagda said, we need to coordinate with the police for clearing traffic like Chennai. And secondly, a small example of how our authorities are insensitive to certain things. Like Dr. Swati Piramal is a classmate of mine and Dr. Supil. She tried for 8 months to release a new molecule for molecular imaging in India because she's a patriot. She wanted to do it in India. But our authorities don't permit anything without a precedence. So she tried, gave up. She got it released abroad and then that she released it here. So we need to look into that for new things because our country, Make in India, has to be given priority now.
I have a tremendous experience when over the tuberculosis things and getting the NABH accreditations here, etc. I've got terrible experiences being in the government on getting the blood banks registered, right? I mean, how we chase up right with government of India, and there is a separate person, not in the health ministry, but well, we'll try to find out. Yeah,
Dr. Two quick points. One is the sale and consumption of junk food. So I feel the national health policy needs to take cognizance of this. Just as we have a municipality demolishing temples on the streets in Mumbai, the sale of junk food, especially in the slums, needs to be monitored. And the other quick point is all our health efforts focus on women, and I feel the national health policy needs to focus on including men and families, because the woman and the mother is focused too much in her responsibility and the men and the family gets caught free. So I think that needs to be included.
Thank you. One here and then Mr. Kulkarni. Yeah, then we
very brief this thing, this right to health which is promised, I think the Right to Health Act, I think that is something which the policy is talking about and is something that has to be come into place in a very time bound manner, because that is we can debate what would be its contours and things like that, but this would ensure that the right to health becomes a reality in this country.
With this Make in India thing coming up and taking up at the international level, there is a need to digress drugs and devices separately, and there is a need to come up with a medical device act rather than clubbing and making a separate chapter under the same act which is prevailing today.
Okay, I think time to, because we are running against time, I don't know how much can be improved upon everybody's goodness here. Important session. So maybe we'll have to cross 215 to 30. 215. Okay, let's settle down for 215 by consensus. Okay. Thanks. I think again very important session, and we got a lot of inputs. I mean, whether we would like to speak only on the right to health or several other things, there's certain different legislations, how they affect the entire healthcare and healthcare industries. But I'll just end up by saying this famous Clinical Establishment Act, which is one of the focus here, etc. We do not even have the listing, we do not have the accreditations of what are health or medical establishment as such in the country, etc. And this leads to, obviously, one is the quality, etc. One is the existence. The issue which was mentioned about quack doctors, for example, I mean, you want the district magistrate and the SP to really hunt for them, prosecute them, etc., etc. I mean, it's a terrible area. How do you go about doing it? If you go to slum areas, I mean, I visited in various capacities here, etc. I find all sorts of fancy qualifications of the doctor, which I don't know where to really, from which university or where they have got it here, etc. It's impossible. Everybody sees it. Nobody does a damn thing about them. Nobody does a damn thing about them. I don't know whether we are incompetent, impotent, I don't know really, or we are apathy here, sir. Let's go to the use of information technology, electronics, data, and the same issues of epidemiological surveillance, for example, and the medical research, all combined. I'm afraid we have to combine. It may not be the best of the combinations, but And we have talked about telemedicines, for example, how the rural people can be approached here, etc. We have talked about electronic medical records. We talked about the Aadhaar, use of the Aadhaar, for example, which was mentioned here. But key issue, among other things, is the epidemiological surveillance systems. In this absence of, we did talk about it, but there's very little known. And right now, we are talking about epidemiological surveillance system only about the infectious and the communicable diseases. We are not even talking about other types of epidemiological surveillance system. Now, what can be done about that? We do not know, honestly, the causes of deaths in our country. We have to rely on that. Forget about morbidity patterns here, etc. We have very little information on that here, etc. Now, who is responsible for this? We were talking about legislation, and I would just like to end this. We have got this registration of births and deaths where people are responsible for doing certain things, etc. Nobody pays a damn thing. As a matter of fact, one of my discussions with Mr. Kulkarni, I was just saying that if I were to advise the Honorable Prime Minister, I would just say, have two things in this country, first of all, is basic governance. We do not have an address system in our country. Just come to think of it, we do not have an address system. I mean, house numberings, this street numbers, villages. There's no villages with road names, for example. You still have to write a very weird way to put it, etc. And we do not have a proof that we are Indian citizens. I mean, that is the fundamentals of the governance in this country, and we had a long discussion on it, but I'll leave it at that. Let's come back to use of information technology and various other things, data, health. Doctor, please.
This was alluded to earlier that we are making policies without proper data, and I want to draw a parallel with what's happening in education. The data that is produced by the Ministry of Education ourselves and what Pratham does. What Pratham does probably is based, self-driven, and probably more accurate and very different from what the government of India produces. So I think it should be ORF who takes up this policy of having data collected through volunteers of what is the state of the real state of health in our country. It will be something which is true on which we can base. It may not be demographic, but for example, everything that is true, which is driven by volunteers. I think Pratham is doing a brilliant job, and some similar agency in health will be of great use.
It's very true, because every time we are trying to plan a policy, I remember so many times I'm on MCI or MOH committees, the same question comes, how many doctors we need of which categories? And then we all the time we have to look at the WHO data or World Bank data, and we have to look at all that. We trying to get our own data is so difficult. And if you really see all the policies for last, say, 20 years we are involved, they're all based on this World Bank or WHO data. We don't have our own data, therefore our predictions could be absolutely wrong. The whole policy of medical education, in which way we are growing, is totally different than what is our needs. And this is a global problem. I mean, if you really look at all over the world, there has been a conference. Recently we attended a conference where the medical education and the health education, are we really fulfilling the needs of the health? And there's a tremendous gap which has come only because of few things, because we are not selecting students properly, we are not training them in the way they want to be, we are urban oriented, we are market driven kind of health policies, and the kind of product we are producing is probably not capable of taking the needs of the country. So the whole data collection, we are best in IT, but we are not using it to ground level. And as Sir rightly said, it's not many times the availability. It's probably our internally also, we don't want to report. Maybe there's a confidential issue in very few cases, but overall we don't want to report the burden. And therefore we are lost into all this game. And therefore whatever we are doing many times remains a directionless kind of effort.
So one of the important ingredients for all policies has to be the data. And absence of data, God knows what we are doing. But let us not focus too much on the data. You obviously would like to say something fair. Use of information technology for improving healthcare and communications and other things, etc. That is area which we need to focus as well while we are speaking about the use of data, the quality of data, gathering of data. Please go ahead. Yeah.
So a couple of things. As you mentioned, Pratham, I'd like to share that in Sneha, we've used mobiles. I have run a community surveillance system recording 30,000 births over 4 years in 44 pockets. So I found that when you take volunteers from the community and pay them an incentive, nominal of 50 rupees, and you cross-check randomly, then you get all the births and deaths in the area.
Yeah, we couldn't compare with the health post data because many of the home births were omitted. We went to the MIS and BMC and we found that the ward level mortality was based on the facility at the ward. So if Sion Hospital is in a particular ward and there are deaths happening in Sion Hospital, that ward's mortality is high. So we couldn't compare our data with that. What I realized is we have data, ICDS has data, BMC have data in the three-room match. So, and one more thing is feeding back data. So when you have a policy and you have data condition, there is no feedback to the people who are actually working at the grassroots level. So that needs to come as processes, maybe in the implementation framework.
I just want to mention that ORF is going to have a roundtable very soon on the use of low impact, low cost, high impact technology, biotechnology solutions for Maharashtra, Mumbai city, and I encourage all of you to send us names of people who you think will be able to, you know, contribute to this roundtable, and even come yourself, you know, if you would invite your participation.
So the invite has already been sent to you. Please respond appropriately. Yeah, we'll just come back. Yeah, please.
Just to bring the basic thing that we send our students to do the survey of adaptability of EHR among the doctors specifically. And there is a huge hindrance which they report back to us that doctors at senior level are not so much adaptable to use of electronic health records. So we have to pitch in at that level if we need to promulgate it to the lower level so that everybody can use electronic health record to create better awareness for the use of ICT.
Thank you. Doctor, I'll just come back here. Just 1 minute, please. I'll come back to you.
Yeah. We need to have our own data. Now, this is true for our weights, how they grow, what is our vitamin B12 level, what should be the vitamin D level. We don't have anything of this. So, market forces are coming. And everybody of us is now vitamin B deficient, vitamin B12. We don't have vitamin D. Earlier it was zinc. Now it is B12. It can be D. So, unless and until we have our own standards, and this is true for our group, young children also, up to 5 years, how they grow. So 47% malnutrition, which is there, and we could make it less by maybe 5% in last 50 years. So the time has come to relook into this, and we have to have our own data on there.
Thank you, doctor, please.
Next month, we are starting a small activity in Devgarh Taluka of Sindhu district. We are calling it as a You Inform, We Perform. We are going to give a toll number to all the people staying in Devgarh Taluka. And we are going to tell them that these 5 events, if you see just report, telephonically or be toll number, suppose an event is reported by 5 people, the first person who reports it will be reimbursed or remunerated after verification of the data. This is the way in which the custom department, excise department gets the tips that some boat is going to deliver some goods or something, or some income tax department, they are using the lay people. Similarly, if we start doing this, in Devgarh Taluka, we will have 1 lakh population, some 50,000 eyes will be there, who will be reporting us. So even if somebody wants to hide or neglect birth report, or any problem with the BCG scar, or any death, or any infant death before the age of 1 year, so some 10 points we are going to tell them. So if this way, instead of recruiting people to pay a home visit, and then get the data, if he goes once a fortnight, all 14 days, somebody may not report also. So this will, employment generation will also be there, and we'll get a verified data also. And remuneration will be given based on the truth, whether it is right or wrong.
Okay, this is an approach, typical WHO approach, when it wants to wipe out a particular disease from the face of the earth. Smallpox in 1970s, it was used. And then they finally came out when they had to really verify whether smallpox has been eliminated from the face of the earth. They said anybody in India would report a case of smallpox, you would get 1,000 rupees in 1970s, so a big amount. I think they have done the same thing now for polios now, etc. So it's a very continuous, but I don't know. Anyway, just by the by.
Just 1 point, I think use of telemedicine is not as much as it should be. That should be part of the policy. Formally, it was not encouraged because of the lack of communication. Now, communication has virtually reached everywhere. Almost close to, may not be all 600,000 villages, but the communication has reached thanks to mobile. So I think this is something which is very important. It's going to be helpful. For the first time, the best of facilities would be available. Why it is still not popular is because there is not much money in that. That's why it is not getting popular. Because when you are communicating with a Hinduja doctor in a village somewhere, that villager is not going to pay you. And that is why there is a lack of that. But if the government were to do it, because then money, revenue will not be the sole consideration, but the availability of medical data would be the consideration.
I just want to talk about medical information systems. Medical information systems and our adoption of these medical system, medical information systems into our hospitals, whether it's public or private, or a private doctor's clinic. Very often, through conversations, I find that it is sometimes doctors and technicians, whether it's a secretary, doctor, secretaries, we don't want to adopt, we don't want to, even though they are available, we don't want to put them into our clinics, we don't want to put them into our hospitals. For collecting patient information, patient records, why should patients be walking around with big bags full of, you know, their medical data when, you know, we can be putting it onto our, in, into our hospitals, into our, you know, have a collective kind of data gathering.
Absolutely, Shaida, what you said is right. We were trying to work with Hero project, you know, for the having a database so that the availability of an intensive beds are there across Mumbai. And the whole concept was that, yes, on a web-based kind of availability, so everybody knows that this place is available, they can contact that doctor and transfer. But there was so much of resistance from people. They were not willing to really share that data because of whatever. Yes.
Only one point. Standardized pattern of patient record, which can be implemented across the country in all the centers, so that we know that this is the format it should be everywhere. So that the multiple software companies coming up with different data and backup plans will be totally, you know, obsolete. So we just need one format of health record.
Okay, I know there are hands, but I just wanted to provoke. Because when we were discussing the issues about lack of teachers and virtual classroom, that is an area I would like. This is where information technology can be used, among other things. You may not multiply the number of academic staff as such here, etc. And a proposal which came is that can you have an evening classes in the medical college so you don't have to really build up infrastructure, etc. That is an area where information technology needs to be used without doubt, actually, etc. And right now, technology allows you, and Mumbai Corporation and other people have done it. Good quality teacher, rather than teaching one particular classroom, they can multiply across simultaneously or in a phased machine. Unfortunately, we have not used this, and I think medical colleges and other area, related areas require the interventions here. But I leave it at that. Please go ahead.
So that is what an excellent suggestion, and in fact, I have planned that with the approval every year, whatever budget we have left surplus, we should make virtual classrooms, because that is a rate contract by the government. So no budget gets wasted. Slowly all of the hospitals get completely virtual classroom and all the seats can increase. And I'm glad that the data thing didn't get stuck to, IT thing didn't get stuck to data. Big data is very important. Both Obama as well as Modi ji won elections because of that. But there's much more to IT than that. And it virtual classrooms and IT can be used for both education purposes, for health purposes, research like video conferencing. And as Mr. Lele said, this is one of my pet projects. I'm already signing it for the next one. Low cost, high impact solutions for telemedicine. One digital camera, one laptop. And now WiMAX has come in, so communication not important. Every 150 kilometers, there needs to be a tower. So underpenetrated areas can also be penetrated. And WiMAX, internet through WiNet, can help a lot of people. Like Tata Hospital, there are so many. Why this started was Tata Hospital, there are so many patients coming who sell their land. And they come here and they're told nothing can be done. So we want to offer, I think on behalf of Dr. Supe, yeah, Dr. Nagda, myself, government sector also, we are willing to take it up for free. Just with the government. I wanted government backing, because even if a private sponsor arranges for the laptop, digital camera, very low cost, somebody can run away with it. Once it comes through the government, people take care and we can implement a very low cost, high impact thing for telemedicine, telereporting, etc.
I think it's very important. I just wanted to draw, I'll just come here. See, the information technology sector in India grew because of providing services in India to people in the Western world, actually. Transcription is the best example for that, actually. And this is an area where we need to now be a little more creative, more imaginative, to use it for our own country where we have got scarce resources. But there is a platform available, there is technology available, and we can do it. Yes, Roxa, please go ahead.
I want to have a dissenting opinion on virtual classrooms. I think it's a dangerous thing. Medicine is not learned in lecture, it is learned by the bedside. And we can have virtual classrooms as an exception and not as a rule, and it cannot substitute for adequate medical colleges and teachers. I strongly am opposed to virtual classrooms.
I don't need to enter into a debate. There will be views and there would be different models. You wanted to say something?
We run this project of standardizing labs.
lab reports for a reputed software company, and half of the hospital that we surveyed did not share their parameters also and values also, which could be used to standardize the template for the lab investigation. Coming on to addressing this gap of education and implementation, we have a subject of hospital information system in our curriculum, but there is no expert faculty available to teach that to the core. If we call industry expert, they lack the academic flavor. So there is a mismatch between this. So that also needs to be addressed.
Raksu, you wanted to say something.
NHP actually provides all the template for all this. Why are you detailing?
Because all this is there in the sections. Use of mobile platform, use of ICT.
Okay.
Death certification needs to be improved because it doesn't give the underlying cause of death, especially if it is malnutrition.
Okay, I think we need to close this session. I know we are hurrying around, but I got my time. I got only 13 minutes to finish off. Last two sessions now. One is on convergence, which we talked about actually, and convergence because we assume that the entire thing has to be handled by the Ministry of Health in Government of India, and down the line we've got the same structure in the states. When you go to the district level, there are more issues. When you go to the corporation, there are greater issues, etc. But we know that there are several issues which are affecting the health of the people in general, etc. For example, let's take the water and sanitation, for example. It's a part of the different ministry, the whole issue of the ambience where people live, etc. Then we have the whole issue of the drug pricing control, which is part of the other ministry, for example, which we talked about. When we talked about women's health and children's health, then it goes to another ministry, for example. And there are all sorts of issues which are there. How do we ensure convergence, actually? Not only convergence within the health ministry as such, but across the department. And this is the main issue. If we are going to talk about malnutrition, will the policy would be also attended by people in the agriculture ministry and the food supplies and so on and so forth? There are several issues which are there, sir. How do we achieve it? We have been fighting for it, etc., but we have not been able to come with the solutions in any case, even in a policy formulation and implementation. So what are the areas of convergence? Number one, I mean, I've just outlined a few. How do we go about doing it and bring it as a policy, and especially during implementation? It's only during a crisis that we seem to be responding, and not outside crisis, actually. So the main governance model we are talking about is day-to-day life and not in a crisis, actually. How do we go about it? So this is an open forum for convergence of sectors which affect health at the end of the day. The right to food, for example, food security, which we've been talking about. We have been talking about several other things. How do we ensure convergence? Open.
Bantha, you were part of our Jan 6 workshop where we discussed this, and a couple of recommendations that came up. One is at the ground level, at the bottom level, where there needs to be merging, like mapping of the areas to avoid duplication, and then merging of the data systems. Say an ICDS has a different MIS, the BMC has a different MIS, and local NGOs have different MIS. And also the recommendation that came up from that group, from senior administrators, was having monthly meetings. So unless there is personal interaction and there is sharing of information and joint planning, all other convergence remains on paper. I think that can be mandated in the policy.
Okay.
But our health people have not recognized many of the such sectors which are influencing health sector. In fact, my first few lines of my drafting was based on this only, that this will be the shocking news for you, that leprosy is a zoonotic disease. Yeah. Tuberculosis is a zoonotic disease. But we have never bothered to approach animal husbandry department, because we don't accept it, that leprosy is a zoonotic disease. This national health policy recognizes that still some transmission is going on and some new incident cases are coming up. Tuberculosis is a zoonotic disease. Our own director of health research, Dr. Katoch, has shown in 2005 that M. tuberculosis, so-called human type of tuberculosis organism, is there in the cattle. Chinese authors, researchers also found out. So in fact, basically we are bothered about nutrition and agriculture. But animal husbandry department, we have never thought that one microbiology head of Bombay Botanic College, I met her
Mrs. Sherikar, she said, you name a bacteria and virus, and I will tell you the corresponding disease in animal world. So first of all, let us list the departments or sectors whom we need to approach. And then we will find out the mechanism in what, unless we are eager to do it, we will not approach it.
Sir, actually, thank you, what doctor. You said
excellent
is
point, I think, being made. Yeah.
The last week only in Zion KM Hospital, we had one complete workshop on zoonotic disorders, where we had invited not only medical people, but also the veterinary people. The dean and vice chancellor of veterinary were there. And the whole concept was from health for all to health in all and one health. Now, the whole concept, we want to change it. But the issue here is of governance. See, we also understand that there are so many people who are involved. But like it's like anatomy, physiology department. We want a doctor who is competent, but we have created silos among ourselves. The same thing, the governance has complete. Now, the question is, over years, if you want to bring a convergence, we have to really have some common agendas where we need to first bring it out and then take that model all over.
Thank you. I'm so happy this is being mentioned, because we are not trying to focus only on the health and nutrition and water and sanitation. Animal husbandry, for example, is a very important issue. Yeah.
Sir, what is important is integration at various level. We talked of modern medicine, Ayush, homeopathy, Yunani. So interdisciplinary integration, interdisciplinary research, interdisciplinary cooperation, and then interdisciplinary implementation. So unless we are in a position to work at that level. Similarly, when we are talking of sanitation, malnutrition, all these areas, which finally focus to one important point, that how do we give excellent care, best care to our patients. So consumer education, that is one of the important area all of us need to address, and how consumer education becomes very vital and to the core of the whole thing. Similarly, when we want various departments to work together, we should have such integrated council from various departments, so that one representative from each becomes a part of the apex body, the nodal body, which can lead to this kind of integrated approach. So what I would sum up in one sentence is, all of us quite often have been talking about sociology in healthcare. Our social scientists give certain perspectives to appreciate the healthcare. Rather than that, let us try to perceive sociology of healthcare and implement it in holistic way.
Thank you. Dr. Supay would like to say, but I just wanted to repeat what I said, the crisis. Dr. Supay gave an excellent example how his medical college really did. At the government level, it doesn't happen except in a crisis. I remember the swine flu epidemics here, same problem. Doctor was talking about Devgarh. Sindhudurg suffered from leptospirosis like mad, etc., and we did not know, and we had to really go to Andamans, we had to go to ICMAR, we had to go to the Bangalore Animal Husbandry Institute. Convergence became a big issue, etc., because we don't understand. And there is another branch known as zoo pharmacology. How do animals treat themselves at the end of the day when they suffer from the same thing? But we, in India, some of the other do not give importance, just like we do not give importance to nursing staff and other things here, etc. We do not give importance to some of these biological sciences, actually.
Dr. Actually, please. One mistake made by engineering department, the whole health department suffers for years. And we had two workshops last 2 years by Harvard people who came and talked about engineering issues in a hospital sector. And it was so eye-opener that how you should really even have built a hospital like that. In fact, if you really look at the history of Harvard today and John Hopkins, all of them have now engineering and medicine really combined together as one department. And they really talk about now holistic kind of this, all this is together. And we are still on silos. Now, there is a lot of convergence we need to do. So the concept is very good. Is the policy what you really need to put it down is more important.
You are absolutely right. We do not have, I mean, I remember standardizing the design of the sub-center, the PSCs, etc., because you know it's ridiculous to say the least. Once upon a time it was good, but we have not changed it. And how do we really put up a 200-bedded hospital and a 500-bedded hospital? We have the same PWD looking after everything. We do not have within that expertise, some or the other. But it requires that expertise. You have to really go through it and work upon that. But it's a very sensitive. I think we need to stop. We are against 2:10, and we are just now the final two things. I think we need to stop if you don't mind, because otherwise I don't mind extending up to 2:45, which may be difficult for most of us. One is, any particular issue which, in your view, has not been touched upon at all in the national health public? If you think something which is very, very exciting, very, very burning, very, very important, then we need to say that. We'll just go through the round, just make one sentence, nothing more than that.
So the capacity building of the whole health professionals.
Okay, fine. Okay, welcome, Dr. Sir. We'll just go through some order here. Anybody would like to make anything? Disability issue. Please, we'll note it down very quickly. Yes, please. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Life cycle approach.
Life cycle approach.
And integration of the role of ASHA, CHV, Anganwadi worker, and ICDS.
There's too many health workers at the ground level.
And community-based monitoring to Rogi Kalyan Samiti.
Community-based monitoring needs to be given more emphasis.
Yeah. Health awareness is not at all talked about.
Okay, health education, health awareness.
So, what's the framework for monitoring and evaluation?
Monitoring and evaluation is pretty weak, not weak.
Disaster management.
Okay, emergency care and disaster management.
Making the PSM more responsible and accountable for public health and getting the primary and tertiary together, like Brazil model.
Okay, the Brazil model.
Yeah, unnecessary giving undue importance to MDG goals. Millennium Development Goals, unnecessary, they are indulging in our all health programs. WHO has been interested to design all the health programs, and so RNDCP revision should have been there after Katoch said that M. tuberculosis is there in Indian cattle. But unnecessary intervention of both international agencies, it be UNICEF, WHO, FDG, Bill Gates, is my strong recommendation for this thing.
Okay, so we need to redefine and put in public domain our new health goals actually. Yes, doctor.
State health policies should be made mandatory before release of funds.
Okay.
Secondly, we should merge at the state level, they should direct FDA, medical education, and services.
Thank you.
Care of the elderly people.
Care of the elderly people, aging population issues which are there. Okay, Dr. Gupta.
Importance of antenatal education, pre-maternal education.
Okay, I think it's time to wind up. We are still at 2:50, but we require Dr. Kulkarni to speak. So, I just wanted to leave it one thought at the end of the day. We talked about the medical officers and very experienced doctors here have said that when they were young, etc., this is the way, etc. I think this whole issue about the course of family physicians in India, that is something which is not there actually. Still, all of us look for a family doctor as such, but we do not have a family physician as such. Some or the other, the specialist thing has got so much into our mind that we bother unnecessarily on the specialist, etc. MUHS, to the best of my understanding, said, well, let us, why not design a family physician course? My understanding is, and I may be wrong, that the only place where you have the course on family physician is Vellore, actually. Why not in several other places? Yeah? But I leave the thought there. I would request now, Mr. Kulkarni has been very, very patient, extraordinarily patient. He is a source of tremendous knowledge, etc. You have been watching him on the TV sets and wherever, etc., participating in all debates, giving a new perspective, etc. So I think you would like to say many things, but I leave it to you.
To intervene in the last segment of the discussion to make a point about what is missing in the draft health policy. You know, although a reference was made here about Millennium Development Goals, the setting of Millennium Development Goals were the United Nations. It's not so much the WHO, but the United Nations as a whole came out and set these goals, and on the whole, it has galvanized the entire international community to work towards achieving certain fundamental objectives in healthcare. But one important now, the target for MDGs will get over in 2015. A major debate that is taking place globally is that the Millennium Development Goals missed out on culture as a resource. You know, we are talking about financial resource, financial investment in healthcare, but it's equally important to understand the tremendous contribution that cultural investment can make for better healthcare. A discussion took place here on community participation, awareness, medical malpractices, how to counter curb medical malpractices, all these ultimately converge on whether we appeal to the morals, the ethics of the practitioners and the system as a whole. And that can only come by harnessing the cultural and spiritual resources of societies, and especially in a country like India. You know, for too long, policy and culture, not only in healthcare but even in other areas, even education for example, they are divorced. The time has come when, you know, we need to dip into our cultural heritage, spiritual heritage, to motivate people to do the right thing. For example, much of primary preventive care, you know, which is going to yield enormous results, you know, it is not going to require much financial inputs, but it is certainly going to require enormous cultural inputs. And those cultural inputs are there in our society, but they are somehow delinked from the healthcare planning, healthcare system. So this is something which I think should be integrated, and we should suggest. But on the whole, since we have come to the very end of the discussion, I must profusely thank Dr. Banthia ji for chairing and moderating this discussion, you know, very ably and knowledgeably, because, you know, he has been a part of healthcare management in government, you know, for years together, right from the bottom to the top. He has passion for it, which, if I may say so, is somewhat rare among civil servants. And without passion, nothing can be achieved. You know, when I said culture as a resource, I think even passion must be regarded as a resource to transform the healthcare system. We've had, you know, for the time that we have devoted to this, we've had excellent and very fruitful discussion. Many good ideas, some very new ideas have come up, and our team here will have its task cut out in the coming days to produce a good report to submit to the ministry. And as you have repeatedly pointed out, we would be extremely benefited by having written contributions from all of you. You may touch upon new aspects that you wish to do so. And Dr. Deepesh and the team at ORF will certainly take all these points, and within the next 10 or 15 days that we have, the ministry will get the best possible inputs on the draft national health policy from Mumbai. But as you rightly pointed out right at the beginning, this is not the end of our consultation. We need to meet together more and more regularly, because just health alone is such a vast topic. So many challenges that have been neglected, by the center, but the neglect at the state level. If I may point out, you know, you've been the chief secretary, but he mentioned that the states don't have a health policy.
We said in the opening session.
And states are not making the adequate amount of investment in health. So there are so many issues, and of course, the very last paragraph of implementation. You know, it is actually an admission of failure.
Yeah.
It's an admission of failure on the part of the government that all the previous policies have not addressed the problem, or if at all, it's only marginally. So there are There are very important issues, and we need to meet more often on specific issues and make very productive contributions to this debate. Friends, at the Observer Research Foundation, you know, we have been participating in this policy debate on various issues, not always with great success, but sometimes the little success that we've got has encouraged us and enthused us that it is indeed possible to get together socially committed professionals within the system, outside the system, examine policies and laws critically, and if we intervene with the force that we collectively have, I think we certainly can make a difference. You know, we had an experience of this a few years ago at the Observer Research Foundation. We had a consultation on the draft National Commission for Higher Education and Research Bill. And I'm happy to say that the report that we produced pointed out all the shortcomings, very critical shortcomings in the bill, and it helped in making the government relook at the bill. Of course, there are many other reasons why the bill has not moved forward. We've also looked at reforms in medical education very critically. We have recently, very recently, done a thorough research report on the municipal corporation's malaria control program, which has achieved some significant success, and there are lessons from it, you know, for many other areas in healthcare. We want to expand our work in public health, and we need your cooperation, we need your
support,
we need your time, and collectively I think we certainly can make a difference. Thank you very much. The lunch is waiting. And once again, thank you, Banthia ji.
Okay, on behalf of all the participants, I think we'd like to thank ORF, because without you, I don't think this platform would have been. Individually, we were thinking, I'm pretty sure you are agitated, but I think we have let out our vent today.
You must thank Dr. Deepesh.
I know.
You know, it is his passion.
I know.
You know, he's a very passionate person, friends.
Yeah, yes. Exactly. So I'm going to take, Ms. Radha is here. She has been sending all the mails, etc. So all this team has been there.
Shahida.
Wait, Shahid. Okay, we need to give a big round of applause to everybody here.
All of you.
Thank you. If I was overbearing at times, etc., no offense meant. We just wanted to ensure that we finish on time. We give opportunity to everybody. We had to cut down some of your interventions, but I'm pretty sure you take it in the right spirit. And I hope that we learn from each contribution made here, etc., which is duly recorded. I don't know whether you'll be able to send a draft also to the participants, but it may be a good idea.
Yeah,
they may like to do it, saying it may be a good idea, but whatever is possible, etc. We look forward. I think public health is a very, very important investment, as I said. We used to say teaching is a noble profession. Medical teaching and medical profession are very, very noble professions. And let's not do anything which is going to dilute its original character, which is of a very high standard. The society needs, whether you like it or not, the medical professional people are the elite of the society in some way or the other, etc. And that includes nursing staff, paramedical, everybody, etc. So let's pray for them and hope for us. Enjoy your lunch. Thank you. We can exchange cards wherever we are.